TV.
Kevin, make this a 1 minute break. Try to come to us right after.
Back at Teague Moore Field, and we welcome in those watching on KLAF TV here in Lafayette, cable channel 17, as we get set for NCAA baseball. We will give you the lineups on the fly because we're going to start this ball game about 5 minutes early. Very quickly for Mcneese State, it'll be Nolan Parker, Stuart Landreneau, and Kevin Mitchell here in the first inning, and here to get you through the first three, Jay Walker.
Thanks, Kyle. Hi, everybody, and welcome in. Parker comes in at 350 on the year. The lefty, Justin Gabriel's first pitch, misses away for ball one. Parker, 17 doubles, a triple, 7 homers, 49 runs batted in. Mcneese State has put up some good offensive numbers this season. And the 1-0 pitch is in for a call strike, and the count is even 1-1. Gabriel on the year, 9 wins, 2 losses, 254, his earned run average. And the 1-1 swung out on a bouncing ball towards short, picked by Heidel, one out. One up and one gone for Stuart Landreneau. The Cowboys' second baseman at 333, 14 doubles, 5 homers, and 42 knocked in. These teams have met twice this year. The Cajuns winning in Lafayette 9-2. Mcneese State winning in Lake Charles 6-5. And in that ball game, this guy, Stuart Landreneau, had the game-winning hit. Gabriel's ready, and the first pitch is laced to left field, a base hit. Going down toward the corner and off the wall, that's extra bases. Landreneau is on his way to second. He's in with his 15th double of the year. And Kyle, he didn't waste any time. Gabriel came with the first pitch fastball, and he jumped on it.
Well, you know, the Cajuns are known for being a very aggressive offensive baseball team, not only on the base pass where they run it extremely well, but at the plate, they don't take a whole lot of pitches. Mcneese State's very similar in that fashion. They're going to swing at a lot of first pitches, especially when they get the fastball.
Kevin Mitchell steps in, 319 hitter. Gabriel's ready to go, and the first pitch cut out and missed as Gabriel came off speed for strike one. Mitchell, 15 doubles, 2 triples, 8 homers, and 53 knocked in. Landreneau at second base has stolen 7. He's been caught twice, but he's in scoring position with one out here in the first inning. Throw back to second, and a pretty close play down there at second base. But Landreneau is back. We've got a full house here tonight. Here's the 0-1. Down in the dirt and a nice block by Mazziotti. And the count of ball and a strike. The Cajuns on defense, Jess Poche at first base, Ryan Gill at second, Rick Heidel at shortstop, Nate Nelson at third, and the outfield with Hawkins, Feehan, and Tommy Clark. Gabriel sets in the 1-1. Just misses a bit low, and the count is 2 balls and a strike. Chris Williamson, who's had just a great year for the Cowboys, waiting on deck. Gabriel comes to the plate, and Mitchell doesn't get it. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Kyle will be updating you as the game goes by. Another NCAA regional game's being played around the country, and there have already been a few surprises today. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 1 out. Gabriel comes to the plate, and a slow hit ground ball foul down the third base side.
Real quickly, one final over in Oklahoma City. UCLA scored 3 runs in the bottom of the ninth to come from behind to beat Delaware by a score of 13-12.
Wow. Delaware led most of that game. There you see, for those of you watching on television, what Gabriel has done this year. 87 strikeouts in 92 innings. He's ready. And again, the 2-2. Just missed inside, and it's 3 balls and 2 strikes.
Over in Columbia, South Carolina and Liberty tied at 2. That one top of the second inning. And in Palo Alto, Alabama leads Nevada 7-2. That one in the top of the 8th.
Gabriel sets in the payoff pitch. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. First one for Gabriel. 2 out of the 1st inning. And now Williamson, the hitter of the year in the Southland Conference. 394 in the year. 14 doubles, 5 triples, 13 homers, and 69 runs batted in. There's the stretch by Gabriel, and the first pitch coming. Outside corner for a strike. Kyle, if there's a reason why Tony Robichaud's throwing a lefty tonight, this is it.
It's Chris Williamson. This guy has had a career against the Cajuns this year. He's had 4 hits and 7 trips. He's hit a home run. He's just had a great season against him.
Pitch low and away for a ball. And remember, in the Cajuns' 2 games against Mcneese, they started left-handers in both games. Andy Groh, the young freshman, got the nod both times. Gabriel sets, and a 1-1 down in the dirt, and a nice block by Mazziotti. And the count is 2 balls and 1 strike.
And you know, Williamson is replacing an All-American from last year at first base. Ben Broussard was amongst the nation leaders in a lot of offensive categories last year. But a lot of people in Lake Charles feel that while Williamson doesn't have the power and the ability to drive the ball out of the ballpark and up the grass, he's a better contact hitter than Ben Broussard was.
Here's the 2-1. Swing and a miss. He doesn't get that Gabriel offering as Justin took something off, and it's 2-2.
However, his contact has not been at its maximum the last couple of games. He is just 2 for his last 21, and in that stretch, his average has dipped 60 points.
Fans want the strikeout. Gabriel comes 2-2, swung on and fouled off. Getting a radio television simulcast tonight. Those of you who are watching on television will probably get more description than you need. But we're trying to take care of our radio audience too. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs and a runner at 2nd. Gabriel's ready. And again, the 2-2 outside, and we're full, 3 balls and 2 strikes. Rand Prince, the third baseman, waits on deck.
Well, you like the pitch Justin Gabriel went with right there. He went with a fastball that was outside of the strike zone. You figured Williamson was looking the hard stuff right there, but Gabriel got it out of the strike zone. Let's see if maybe he comes back with a changeup down and in.
3-2, swung on, well hit right field. Clark goes back to the wall, and that ball is off the wall. Coming in to score is Landreneau. Williamson is in with a double, and it is 1-0 Mcneese State.
Well, it was a changeup, but if you're going to throw that type of pitch, you've got to be able to get it down in the strike zone and more in on the plate. Gabriel left that one out over the middle of the plate, and any good hitter is going to be able to hit that 3-2 pitch that's out over the middle of the plate, because he doesn't care what pitch you throw in that count. If it's over the white part of the plate or over the black part of the plate, he's hacking. So Gabriel made a nice pitch right there in his decision to throw it, but the adjustment on making that pitch and the execution just was not there.
Here's Rand Prince, 242 in the year, 6 doubles, 5 homers, 33. Runs batted in. In the last 11 games, in the last 10 games the Cajuns have played, we'll give you the stat in a minute. Outside corner for a strike. The last 10 games the Cajuns have played, the team that has scored first has won. And the Cajuns now will have to try to break that streak tonight. 0-1 pitch outside, a ball and a strike. Feehan in center field, plays Prince the other way. Hawkins and Clark are straight away. Williamson didn't miss a home run by much. Pitch cut out and missed, and it's 1-2. We had a nice breeze blowing in earlier today out of the south during the game between East Carolina and Marist, won by the Pirates 12-3. But that wind has died down considerably now, so you may be able to get one out of here tonight. Gabriel ready, and the 1-2. Swung on, hit to right center field. That one is going to fall in for a base hit. Tommy Clark on one bounce. Coming in to score is Williamson, and it's 2-0. So So the Cowboys make an early statement against Gabriel as both Prince and Williamson get two out, two strike hits to drive in runs. For Prince, his 34th run batted in of the year.
Mississippi State leads South Alabama 1-0 down on the top of the third at Starkville. Over at Clemson, South Carolina, the Tigers and Middle Tennessee State scoreless in the bottom of the fourth inning. And in Tempe, it's Texas 4, Creighton 2, that one top of the eighth.
Doug Cormier, the hitter, 276 in the year, 5 doubles, 2 triples, 4 homers, and 28 knocked in. Prince has 11 steals, which is second on the club, and Gabriel will keep a close look at him. Pitch to Cormier way up and away for ball one. So the Cowboys with three hits off Gabriel here in the first inning, and they lead it 2-0.
Down in Coral Gables, Miami has jumped on Wagner early, 6-1 bottom of the second. Bethune-Cookman and Florida State scoreless top of the third in Tallahassee.
Here's the 1-0. Swung on and fouled out of play, and the count is even 1-1.
A couple of other games in progress over in Fullerton. Tennessee leads Virginia Tech 6-2, that one in the bottom of the fifth. And Georgia Tech and Georgia Southern knotted at 3, bottom of the second in Atlanta.
Now you're up to date. Here's the pitch, swing and a miss. And Cormier's in a hole, a ball and two strikes. But there's been two strike hits that have gotten Mcneese on the board here in the first inning. Winner gets East Carolina tomorrow at 4. The loser plays at 3, rather. The loser plays at 11 tomorrow morning. There's strike 3 called, and the inning is over. What a productive inning for the Cowboys. They get 2 runs, 3 hits, no Cajun errors, and a man left. And our score at the end of a half inning of play. Cowboys 2, and the Cajuns coming to bat.
Springtime, and that means the 2000 Men's College World Series returns to Omaha, Nebraska. Don't miss the best teams in college baseball slug it out at Johnny Rosenblatt Stadium, June 9th through the 17th. For tickets, call 402-422-1212. That's 402-422-1212. Or log on to NCAAChampionships.com.
Fred's Plumbing and Electric in Maurice now offers a free 10-year warranty on Train's XL Series air conditioning and heat pump units. It's hard to stop a train from Fred's Plumbing and Electric in Maurice.
The Ragin' Cajuns in the NCAA Regionals, brought to you in part by Iberia Bank, an independent Louisiana bank. They're working for your business. And by Quality Brands, distributors of Miller and Kurz products. These sponsors pleased to bring you University of Louisiana Baseball, the Regionals.
Bottom of the first we go from Teague Moore Field. The Cowboys get 2 runs in the first inning off Justin Gabriel on 3 hits. Let's check the Cajun lineup real quick. Feehan in center. Ryan Gill at second base. Nathan Nelson over at third. Danny Maziotti behind the plate this afternoon batting in the cleanup spot. Will Hawkins in left. Tommy Clark in right. Jess Poche at first base. Scott Atwood in the DH role. Rick Heidel at shortstop. All of those guys will face Chris Howie, one of the toughest customers in the country, a big right-hander, the Southland Conference Pitcher of the Year, 11-2 on the season, an earned run average of 3.45, making his 19th appearance, his 14th as a starter, an amazing 10 complete games on the season for Howie, 120 innings, 114 hits, 79 strikeouts, 44 walks. Opponents hit .252 against him.
Might be important for the Cajuns tonight to show a little bit of patience as Howie is averaging almost 4 walks per 9 innings. Feehan steps in, 326 on the year, 18 doubles, 2 triples, 6 homers, and 27 runs batted in. Feehan, during the Sun Belt Conference tournament, became the all-time hits leader in Cajuns history, surpassing Oswaldo Aguirre. And the first pitch is in for a called strike, and Feehan was taking all the way.
And Chris Howie, with his 11 victories this season, that sets a Mcneese single-season record.
Howie ready, the 0-1, and Feehan takes that one away, and a ball and a strike. Howie, fastball slider. And as you heard Tony Robichaud say, he's got to keep the ball down. If he gets it up, he can get in trouble. But if he keeps it down, he's a very tough customer. 1-1 pitch. That one misses away, and it's 2-1. Ryan Gill and Nathan Nelson will face Howie here in the first inning. Mcneese leading it 2-0, bottom half of the first.
And Howie's an aggressive type pitcher. He'll go at you with that fastball, but he's not coy either. He'll throw the slider in odd counts.
2-1, low, 3-1. Bottom half of the first inning. East Carolina defeated Marist 12-3. ECU actually trailed in that game at one time, 3-2. There's a ground ball hard hit, but Prince is up with it. Throw over to first base to get Feehan by a step, and there's one down.
It's a nice play by Rand Prince over at third, a ball that was hit pretty hard and on really one big hop. The second hop was a short one on Prince, and the really only play he had was just to try to smother it. He was actually able to glove it. When he went down to a couple of knees, he lost his balance. Nice job to regain his composure and make a strong throw.
Here's Ryan Gill. There you see the stats on him, those of you on television. On radio, 355. Make it 353. 21 doubles, 2 triples, 4 homers, and 35 runs batted in. Gill closing out a fine career with the Cajuns this season. That pitch is fouled out of play, and the count is 1-1 to him. There, for those of you on television, a look at the capacity crowd tonight here at Teague Moore. Believe the sign has been hung out on the door. No admittance. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Gill takes that one inside. 2-1. Cajuns leading hitter Nate Nelson waits on deck. Here's the 2-1. Swung on, ground ball toward first, gloved by Williamson, and he'll make the play himself. 2 outs. When Howie has got his good stuff, yes, he'll strike out his share, but he'll also get a lot of ground ball outs, and he gets 2 of them here in the first inning. Here's Nelson at 371, 13 doubles, a triple, 5 homers, and 40 runs batted in. Nelson had the longest home run that we have seen this year. It came in the Sun Belt Conference Tournament against South Alabama. Pitch is a breaking ball, and it stays high for 1. Nelson's home run, if for those of you familiar with Teague Moore Field, would have gone over the clock about 15 feet higher than the clock when it left the ballpark. There's a bouncing ball toward the middle, but moving over is Kaiser. And Howie's got a 1-2-3 inning in the first.
I couldn't hit it over the clock from second base, Joe.
No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. Your score at the end of 1, Mcneese 2, Louisiana nothing.
Shh, I have a secret.
The secret's out. Courtesy of Vermilion's lot is loaded with Buick and Pontiac program cars, all with low, low monthly payments. The popular Buick LeSabre, Century, Regal, sporty Pontiac Grand Ams, and Sunfires. Program cars with low payments. Credit problem? No problem. Courtesy's got easy financing no matter what the reason. Courtesy of Vermilion Charity Street, Abbeville. Courtesy's got your wheels, man.
Meeting for the third time this season. The Cajuns took a 9-2 win here at Teague Moore Field on March 1st with Andy Grove getting his first collegiate victory. Gordon O'Brien got the loss. Chris Howie got the win back on April 25th at Mcneese State, 6-5 Cowboy win.
And the first pitch to Marty Guillory is up high for 1. Guillory 268. 3 doubles, 2 homers, and 16 knocked in. There's a fly ball hit to center field. Feehan moves over, 1 out. Kyle mentioned Howie getting the win down in Lafayette. 2 2/3 innings of relief. Gave up 3 hits and a run. The 1 run he gave up was a solo homer to Will Hawkins. which at the time had given the Cajuns a 5-4 lead, but Mcneese got one in the eighth to tie and one in the ninth to win. Josh Salo, the catcher. Pitch fouled off for strike one. Seven doubles, 12 runs batted in, hitting at 229. First four in Mcneese's lineup have great statistics, but there is a drop-off after that. Count is 1-1 to Salo. Tried to check his swing on a breaking ball and couldn't, and it's one ball and two strikes.
Well, that's the pitch that Gabriel wanted to throw in that two-strike count to Chris Williamson. That one was down and away, the one that Williamson hung out over the plate.
Wind up and the 1-2. Just missed. A bit inside, two balls and two strikes. Jason Kaiser, the shortstop, waits on deck. Gabriel ready again, and again the 2-2. There's strike three called. Number three in the game for Gabriel, and there are two outs. Three in a row retired by the left-hander, and here's Kaiser. 3-10 on the year, 10 doubles, 3 homers, 21 knocked in. Gabriel, not a very big guy, about 5'9". He's out of Seattle, Washington, and Lassen Junior College. And despite his small stature, he is expected to be drafted in the June amateur draft coming up next week. First pitch, ground ball towards short. Heidel scoops, fields. Hoche with a tag, and the inning is over. Up and down for Mcneese State in the second inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. After an inning and a half, your score, Cowboys 2, the Cajuns nothing.
It's Thomasville Home Furnishings Special Memorial Day Sale, May 11th through May 30th. Take advantage of Memorial Day rebates on all living and dining room sets, 50% off all beds and mattresses, excluding Hemingway, and 20% off all accessories. Thomasville offers free delivery and is the only manufacturer with a 3-year factory warranty. This Memorial Day Sale is a once-a-year event. Go by Thomasville for your home furnishing needs and save. And as always, 6 months interest-free financing available. Thomasville Home Furnishings, 2015 Johnston Street, next to campus.
Take it from me. You want great fried chicken? You gotta work for it, honey. You gotta look for the biggest pieces. And you got to marinate them for hours. You taking notes, honey? You gotta stand over a hot stove all day long, miss your soaps? You gotta be out of your mind.
Try Church's Chicken. It's what made from scratch should taste like. Get 10 big pieces of delicious Church's Chicken, all made from scratch for the great price of $4.99.
Girl, he ain't no good for you. Gotta love it.
As we go to the bottom half of the second inning, let's set up the Cowboys defensively for you. Parker is in left. Cormier is the center fielder with Guillory flanked over in right. The left side of the infield has Rand Prince in third and Jason Kaiser at shortstop. Stuart Landreau is the second baseman with Chris Williamson at first. Josh Salo behind the plate and Chris Howie on the mound this afternoon for Mcneese State. The Southland Conference Pitcher of the Year, for those of you on television, 11-2 with an earned run average of 3.45. Cajuns here in the second inning, 4-5-6, Maziotti, Hawkins, and Clark.
Maziotti, the All-Sunbelt Conference catcher. 290 on the year, 13 doubles, 2 triples, 13 home runs, and 36 runs batted in. The coaches respecting Maziotti's all-around game, putting him on the first team all-conference despite the fact there was a guy in New Orleans who hit 370 with 17 home runs and 71 runs batted in. First pitch in for a called strike. Maziotti, and it's very rare in the college game, calls every pitch of every game. Usually the coaches call the pitches from the dugout in college. 0-1, breaking ball, and it's 0-2. And quickly, Howie is ahead on the count.
And that's as much of a reason as his batting average and his runners caught stealing as any to put him on that first team Sun Belt team.
Here's the 0-2. That's away, a ball and two strikes. Kyle mentioned Howie was named the pitcher of the year in the Southland. He's a good one. He really was the number two man for a good part of the year. And then Jared Gautreaux got hurt. And Howie moved up to the number one spot. 1-2 to Mazziotti, swung on, hit pretty well the left center field. But moving over is the center fielder Cormier, and that ball didn't carry at all. One out. This is Howie's first year with the Cowboys. Central Arizona Community College is where he came from. Howie is out of New Westminster, British Columbia. So a couple of Canadians. Cajuns have one as well. First pitch to Will Hawkins is down low for ball one. Hawkins at 282. Six doubles, eight homers, 35 runs batted in. We mentioned Hawkins homered off Howie down in Lake Charles. It's the last home run that Hawkins hit this year. That one's fouled off, and the count is even, 1-1.
You mentioned Jared Gautreaux. He's a guy that's had some injury problems throughout his career. He had some shoulder problems toward the end of last season. They weren't sure how well he was going to be able to come back this year. Got off to a 9-1 start, then broke his ankle in a game against Louisiana Monroe back on April 8th. Hasn't pitched since.
Actually, he broke a bone in his arm on a line drive hit back to him.
That's cool.
And right about the time he was cleared to throw, he went into the bullpen to start throwing, tripped on the mound, and that's how he broke his ankle. But it's a very small bone that he broke, and he's listed as questionable for the tournament. One ball and two strikes, the count to Hawkins. Howie's ready. And the pitch, a breaking ball, and didn't break. Hawkins had to duck out of the way, and the count is even, 2-2. Tommy Clark, the on-deck hitter. Cajuns as a club coming in have hit 68 home runs, and that is just five shy of the school record. Pitch cut on, missed by Hawkins. Gets away, but Hawkins didn't notice, and so the throw will go down to first base in time for the out. Hawkins never knew that the catcher had missed the ball. It went all the way back to the backstop, but Hawkins got a late start out of the batter's box, and as a result, he is gone, and there are two down, and that'll bring up Tommy Clark. Clark at 273, 12 doubles, 3 triples, 6 homers, and 38 runs batted in. First pitch in for a call strike. Said the Cajuns have hit 68 home runs. Mcneese, by contrast, has hit 54, which is still a pretty good total. Here's the 0-1. Down low, a ball and a strike. Five in a row retired by Howie to start the game. And for those of you who haven't seen the Cajuns a lot this year, it has not been unusual to see the Cajuns go once through the order and not get much done and then come back the second time around and do well. Two balls and a strike, the count to Clark. Jess Poche, the first baseman, is hoping for a chance on deck. Clark steps out, now back in. They're playing him to pull in the Mcneese outfield. That pitch, line drive, and there's the first hit of the ball game for the Cajuns. Two out single by Tommy Clark. Louisiana has its first base runner, and here's Jess Poche. Poche at 256, 11 doubles, a triple. He's got 9 home runs and has driven in 29. Poche has seen a lot of time both at first base and designated hitter. He and Scott Atwood both play the same position. Poche gets the nod defensively tonight, and Atwood is the DH, and he waits on deck. First pitch, a breaking ball on the outside corner, strike one. And that is the book on how to pitch Poche. If you get behind on the count and you come with a fastball, you're taking your life into your hands. But Jess is shown to be susceptible to the breaker at times. There's the pitch, and that's swung on and hit deep to right field. Going back, but it is foul. Plenty of home run distance, but foul. And Howie's ahead on the count, two strikes and nothing.
Well, you talk about baseball being a game of inches. That was fouled by about, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 feet, but the inch comes in the bat angle right there. If you get your hand started about a 2/10 of a second earlier, the bat angle is there, that ball leaves the yard and it's 2-2. So not inches in how far foul it was, but inches in how far the bat was through the hitting zone.
Instead, it's a long strike. And it's nothing and two. Howie ready. And the pitch, and Poche fouls that one off. That one probably out of the strike zone. One ball and two strikes. Tommy Clark is at first base. He has stolen 10 bases. He's one of four Cajuns that have stolen 10 or more this year. He's been caught four times, and Cajuns, of course, want to try to get a runner in scoring position, so we won't be surprised if they start Clark, even though they're down two runs. Throw over to first base. Howie must have an earpiece listening to the broadcast. They play Poche straight away. Cormier, the center fielder, couple of steps to right center. And again, the 0-2 to Poche. Popped him up, short right field, in foul territory, toward the box seats, and that one's out of play. So Poche still has life at nothing and two. Parker, Cormier, and Guillory in the outfield for Mcneese State. Prince, Kaiser, Landrino, and Williamson third to first in the infield. And Salo behind the plate. Again the stretch, and again the 0-2. Swing and a miss, he struck him out. Second strikeout in the game for Salo, and the Cajuns are gone in the second inning. No runs a hit, no errors, and one left, and our score at the end of two, Cowboys 2, and the Cajuns nothing.
Hello, Acadiana, it's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi, and I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a 5-year warranty. Or a brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a 5-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
Every day, people all across the state are saving money on their car insurance. It's as easy as ABC. ABC Insurance Agency sells car insurance for less than anyone else, even those companies that say they're direct. We use our computers to shop dozens of reputable companies to find the lowest price for you, and we're here to help you when you need us. Call ABC Insurance Agencies at 981-0123 and get car insurance for less. ABC Insurance Agencies, Louisiana's best coverage.
Cajuns get their first base hit of the game off Chris Howie, a two-out single from Tommy Clark, but a strikeout of Jess Poche. Ends the Cajun second. It's still 2-0 Mcneese as we go to the top of the third inning and the top of the Mcneese batting order, Parker, Landrino, and Mitchell.
Parker grounded out his first time up. Left-handed batter to face the left-hander, Justin Gabriel. Mike Bianco is made a couple of changes in his lineup to accommodate the left-hander, but not that one. That's a base hit to center field on the first pitch of the third inning. Parker and Williamson, of course, stay in the lineup. And Parker has the leadoff hit. The third, make it the fourth, given up by Gabriel in the ballgame. That'll bring up Stuart Landrino. Landrino doubled his first time up right down the left field line. He scored the Cowboys' first run on Williamson's double. And the first pitch down and in for ball one. Cowboys lead it 2-0. We play on the top of the third. Jim Jackson is calling the balls and strikes tonight. Joe Cacciatore at first base. Jeff Heinrich at second. And John Magnuson is the umpire at third. 2-0 the count. You're not going to recognize any of those names because they've been brought in from all over the country. Gabriel ready. His pitch grounded to third, past Nelson into left field, base hit. Around second is Parker. He's on his way to third and will make it as the throw comes into second base. And the Cowboys have him at the corners with nobody out and the wrecking crew getting ready to come up.
Well, we mentioned at the top of the broadcast how Mcneese was a fairly aggressive offensive club, and what they have done tonight is that they've been aggressive in all counts against Justin Gabriel. Nolan Parker with the single up the middle on the first pitch. We saw in the first inning a couple of two-strike base hits, rather, for Mcneese State. What they're doing is they're being selective on certain pitches. They're trying to get after that Justin Gabriel fastball because it's not a Scott Doman fastball. It's not an overpowering type fastball. Now, he has the type of velocity that he can get it by people, but it's got to be in the right count. And Mcneese is being selective in count. They're going to the plate with a plan off Justin Gabriel. They're being aggressive, but they're doing it at the right time.
Here's Kevin Mitchell. He struck out his first time, and Gabriel needs one of those in the worst way. Nelson will play on the edge of the grass at third. Shortstop and second will look for the double play. Poche holding on Landreau, who has stolen seven this year. And the first pitch misses outside for ball one. Gabriel has the only pickoff on the Cajun staff this year. Pitch outside for a ball. It's 2-0. And you're playing with fire here because you got Williamson on deck. There's the change, and he swung through it 2-1.
Well, Mitchell this season, 9 at-bats against the Raging Cajuns, no hits. That strikeout in the first inning gave him 4 strikeouts against Cajun pitching this year as well. So even though he's in a pretty good situation here with a 2-ball, 1-strike count, his success against the Cajuns this year hasn't been real good.
And now the count is even 2-2 as Gabriel hits the outside corner. Feehan plays to the pull side. Hawkins gives up a lot of room. They pinch the left center field gap in the outfield. Pitch fouled out of play, and it stays 2-2. Nick Webb is scheduled to go for the Cajuns tomorrow. Here's the pitch, swung on and fouled out of play. Scott Doman is scheduled to pitch third. And Andy Groh, if there is a fourth game. There's the stretch and the 2-2. Just missed low, and the count is full. 3 balls and 2 strikes. Cowboys have out hit the Cajuns 5-1, and they're threatening here with a 2-run lead. 3-2, nobody out, runners at the corners. And the payoff pitch from Gabriel, grounded towards second, and a bad hop. Gill flips not in time, and everybody's safe. The ball came up. It was a double play ball, and it came up on Gill, took a bad hop, and hit him in the shoulder. A run comes in to score, and everybody's safe, and we'll wait to see how they score it. They're going to give Gill a very tough error. His 8th of the year. Credit Mitchell with a run batted in, his 54th.
Well, the error there doesn't go to Ryan Gill because he made a bad physical play. I think maybe the reason they're giving him an error is they feel that if he would have charged the ball, that bad hop would not have taken place and that had gotten at least the force at second.
Here is Williamson, who doubled home a run in the first inning. The first pitch is outside for ball one. So deep trouble here for Gabriel in the second. The Cajun bullpen right now is quiet. And the pitch. Outside, off the glove of Mazziotti, and the runners will move up to second and third.
It's going to be a pass ball on Mazziotti.
For Mazziotti, that is his 11th of the year. He had a couple in the Sun Belt Conference tournament. His 13th of the year. And the count is 2-0. Oh, yeah. 2-0 pitch, cut out and missed, threw a breaking ball out of the strike zone, and Williamson went after it 2-1.
Well, you ever heard dead red fastball? You ever heard that comment?
He was looking for it right
he
there.
He was looking dead red fastball.
Two balls, one strike to count. Gabriel is going from the full windup. 2-1 pitch, cut out and missed, 2-2. And he threw him another breaking ball out of the strike zone. Landreau at third, Mitchell at second. Nobody out and a run in for Mcneese. They lead 3-0. Winding Gabriel, the 2-2. Swing and a foul ball at the plate. Just got a piece of it. Winner of this regional will play the winner of the Columbia, South Carolina regional in the best 2 out of 3 to see who goes to the College World Series. Wind up and the 2-2. Swing and a miss. He struck him out, and a nice piece of pitching by Gabriel right there.
Well, you get behind the count 2-0, and Chris Williamson is thinking there that the advantage in that at bat goes to him. And normally you would say yes, but Justin Gabriel realizes that you don't throw fastballs to a guy like Chris Williamson, who can hit a 3-run bomb right here. If he's going to hit a 3-run bomb or hurt you, you make him hurt you on a pitch that you want him to swing at. And that's what Gabriel did right there with 3 breaking balls. Nice job.
Far from being out of the woods, though, as Rand Prince steps in, single and an RBI back in the first inning. And the first pitch, nice one on the inside corner, strike one.
Well, if there's one thing that Justin Gabriel is that he's a battler, and he's a fighter.
There's the line drive, coming hard as Feehan, he can't get it. That'll score another run, and it's 4-0. So Prince is 2-for-2. And 35 runs batted in now for him.
Gabriel, although he is a fighter, he might should have brought maybe a club and some armor with him this afternoon, because Mcneese is 6 hits already in the ball game. We're in the top of the third inning, and yeah, he's just having a difficult time throwing all the pitches he wants all the time. He did a great job against Chris Williamson, throwing 3 breaking balls out of the strike zone, making Williamson swing at the pitches that he wanted to, but he's just not being consistent with that. He's making some mistakes and some counts that don't favor him, and he's getting hurt because of it.
Runners are at first and third, still just one out. Doug Cormier was called out on strikes his first time. Cajuns would like the double play to get out of the inning. That one instead is hit to right field. Clark moves back, should be deep enough to get a run home. Tagging at third is Mitchell. That run will be unearned, but it'll count just the same. And Mcneese has put up 5 on the Cajuns and lead it 5-0 here in the third inning. For Cormier, his 29th run batted into the year. Holding at first base is Prince. But Mcneese has done the very thing that Tony Robichaux preaches and preaches and preaches. Don't let the opposition have a 3-run inning. And they've got one here in the third. Marty Guillory flying to center his first time up. And the first pitch is a changeup, swung on and missed for strike one. There's warm-up activity in the bullpen, and it's Andy Groh who is throwing down there. Throw over to first base, and the runner is back. Mcneese has touched Gabriel for 6 hits through 2 2/3 innings. 4 of the 5 runs are earned. That pitch misses down and in for a ball, and it's 1-1. Had that ball not taken the hop on Gill and the Cajuns gotten the double play, they'd be out of the inning a long time ago, and they would have given up just 1 run. The pitch cut out and missed. It's 1-2. And the pitch, fastball, and he fouled it off. And the count stays a ball and two strikes. All sorts of folks out here at the ballpark tonight. Here it comes. There it goes. Ground ball foul outside of third. Mike Bianco, the Mcneese State coach, stays in the dugout. His assistant coaches take care of the base duties. Same thing with the Cajuns. Bianco, of course, former player under Skip Burtman and a former coach under Burtman as well. Time called now, and Guillory steps out. And now the pitch. Bouncing ball towards short. Heidel has to back up on it. Long throw, got him, and the inning is over. But a big inning for the Cowboys as they get three. They do it on three hits. There was a Cajun error and a man left, and our score at the end of 2.5. Mcneese State 5 and Louisiana nothing.
For the do-it-yourselfer, housing contractor, and general contractors, Premium Equipment Rentals handles only top-of-the-line equipment, including New Holland, Komatsu, Honda, Wacker, Stihl, DeWalt, and many more. Only Premium Equipment Rentals offers free delivery and pickup, and all customers receive instructions on safe, effective, and efficient use of equipment. Check out our new equipment, mini excavator, man lift, Wacker packers, power trawls, and Honda garden tillers. Count on Premium Equipment Rentals for your next project.
Well, my brother and I have a formwear operation. We rent tuxedos and sell tuxedos. We've been operating for 30 years. I've been banking San Martin Bank for 4 years. There's no hassle. There's just friendly service. And I like that. That's how we run our business, and that's something I look for in a bank when we choose a bank. The decisions are made here locally, not being made out of state. I would definitely recommend San Martin Bank to anyone looking for a new bank. Friendly, simple, and trustworthy.
Justin Gabriel's been roughed up through the first three innings by the Mcneese State bats as the Cowboys lead it by a score of 5-0. As we go to the bottom half of the third inning, Chris Howey on the other side has retired 6 of the 7 Cajun batters he's faced. Only a Tommy Clark single broke that up. And as we head to the bottom of the third, it's 8-9-1 for the Cajuns. Scott Atwood, Rick Heidel, and Stephen Feehan.
Atwood hitting at just 210. 8 doubles, 4 home runs, 15 knocked in. Atwood came in with glowing credentials out of junior college, where he hit 41 home runs over 2 years. But really has had trouble adjusting to Division I this year. Howie's first pitch is up high for ball one. Two of Atwood's home runs, however, came in the Sun Belt Conference tournament, showing some signs of breaking out. Here's the 1-0. That's up high, 2 balls and no strikes. Atwood out of Columbus, Mississippi, went to a junior college in Florida and was highly recruited by Ole Miss and Mississippi State. Decided to come here instead, and he swings through a Howie fastball, and it's 2-1. Rick Heidel then will go up top to Stephen Feehan. 2-1 from Howie is outside, 3 balls and a strike. Atwood's dad has come in from the state of North Carolina to see his son play this weekend. Got a chance to meet him during that first game this afternoon. The windup and the 3-1. Inside ball four, and the Cajuns have the lead man on here in the third inning. That'll bring up Rick Heidel, the All-Sun Belt Conference shortstop at 281, 13 doubles, 4 triples, 6 homers, 32 runs batted in. Heidel has been a very streaky hitter all year long. Leads the team in strikeouts, but has been in grooves when people just couldn't get him out. That first pitch is a beauty at the knees for strike one. Feehan, the top of the order, waiting on deck. Here's the 0-1. Up high, a ball and a strike. Cajuns have just one hit, a two-out single by Tommy Clark in the second inning. But they're getting ready to go through the second time in the lineup. 1-1 pitch on the outside corner, and a good pitch by Howie, 1-2. Even if Heidel swings, you just can't hit that pitch. A ball and two strikes. Atwood, no threat to run. Here's the 1-2. Inside, two balls and two strikes. Cajuns have an error in this game. They only made one error in five games in the conference tournament. 2-2 pitch. Swung on and fouled out of play, and Heidel stays alive, 2-2. The outfield plays Heidel very shallow despite the fact that he's got six home runs. Howie has given up 11 this year. And the pitch swung on and fouled off again. And Heidel staying alive here in the third. Mcneese with two in the first inning and three in the third, lead it 5-0. Andy Groh, who was warming up for the Cajuns, is now sat back down. Again, the stretch, and again, the 2-2 pitch. Outside, 3-2. Ball gets away momentarily from Salo, but not very far, and Atwood, who does not run well, holds up. Three balls, two strikes, nobody out, and a runner at first. Fans want to see ball four. Howie's ready. And the 3-2, swung on, hard hit ball, but right at the shortstop. Kaiser to second, one to first, double play. Heidel hit it on the button, but a one-hopper right to Kaiser, and Landreau turned it at second, and there are two outs. 50th double play that Mcneese State has turned this year, and the 37th turned against the Cajuns. And now here is Feehan. Grounded to third, his first time up. And he's hit by the pitch. Now the double play looks very big indeed. That's the 10th batter that Howie has hit this year. And the Cajuns have a two-out base runner for Ryan Gill.
And really a good job turning that double play by Landreau down at second base, because the Cajuns had started Atwood, and he was bearing down on Landreau trying to turn that double play at second base. But Landreau realized that the ball was hit very hard and sharply. And therefore, once he fielded the ball from the shortstop Kaiser, he stepped across the bag and realized that the ball was hit so hard that he had time to gather himself and make a strong throw instead of trying to rush it.
First pitch to Gill, misses low for ball one. Ryan grounded to first, his first time up. Gill had a good conference tournament. He had 10 hits in the five games. He and Feehan tied for the team lead in that department. Here's the pitch. There's a hard hit ball, base hit left field. Up with it is Parker. He'll get it back in. Stopping at second is Feehan, and here's Nelson. Grounded to short, his first time up. There you see Feehan down at second base for those of you watching on television. Nelson, 371 on the year. Believe it or not, that is 50 points lower than what he hit a year ago when he hit 420 despite missing 24 games with a broken bone. First pitch on the outside corner for strike one. Nelson also hit very well in the NCAA regional and super regional last year despite having a partially torn hamstring.
Yeah, 11 out of 26, seven runs driven in. Six scored, couple of doubles.
0-1 from Howie. Runners are going. Pitch misses. Throw down to third. Not in time. Feehan gets the steal and Gill on the back end. For Feehan, his 12th stolen base of the year. For Gill, his 19th. And now if Nelson can get a base hit here, the Cajuns can get a pair. Gill is the fastest Cajun, and he is at second base. Feehan, Gill, and Nelson all run very well. And the crowd just dying for a chance to get into this game. Trying to make it happen with two outs here in the third inning. 1-1 to Nelson. Outside 2-1. Mazziotti is next. Should Nelson get on?
And Nelson, we gave you his numbers from last year. He did most of that damage in the NCAA regional at Houston. Named the MVP of that regional.
He and Hawkins just had outstanding tournaments.
Hawkins had 12 hits as well.
2-1 pitch. Swung on and a hit down the right side, but that slice is foul out of play. And the count is 2-2. Nelson a bit upset with himself. I think he liked that pitch.
And even though last year's Cajun team was built around its great pitching staff, in the NCAA regionals and super regionals a year ago, four Cajuns had double-digit hits. Feehan with 10, Gill with 12, Nelson with 11, and Hawkins with 12.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Howie's ready. Here it is. Swing and a miss. He struck him out to end the inning. For Howie, his third strikeout of the game, and the Cajuns can't get the two-out hit. No runs, one hit. No errors, two left, and our score at the end of three. Mcneese State 5 and the Cajuns nothing.
Welcome to our Newsims at 4605 West Congress. In continuing our commitment of service to a growing Acadiana, now there are three Zim's locations to better serve our customers.
Zim's offers the finest in quality Bridgestone tires with Bridgestone Unity, the ultimate tire technology.
Zim's provides total automotive care with dependable, reliable, top quality parts and service.
Zim's, we're not just alignments anymore.
It's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi. I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a 5-year warranty. Or a brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a 5-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
We'll go to the fourth inning, and Mcneese State will send up their 8-9-1 hitters, Salo Kaiser, and then the top of the order in Nolan Parker. They've got six hits off Justin Gabriel over the first three innings, and they lead this game by the score of 5-0. So the Cajuns have their work cut out for them. As we get ready to go to the top of the fourth, Kyle, I wasn't very good from a Cajun fan standpoint. For the next three innings, I'll turn things over to you.
If you keep this up, we're going to put you in blue and gold. First pitch to Josh Shallow is a breaking ball from Gabriel in for a strike. Shallow looked at a called third strike back in the second, two out of four against the Cajuns this year, and he can't get a breaking ball this time on the inner half from Gabriel, and it's nothing and two. Gabriel had a couple of two-strike counts when he was ahead of hitters in the first inning and gave up three base hits. 0-2 pitch to Salo. Change up missed down and away, and it's a ball and two strikes. Salo, Kaiser, and Parker here in the fourth inning for the Cowboys, who have six hits off the Cajun junior. Fastball missed away, 2-2. Two in the second for the Cowboys, three in the third. One of them in the third was an unearned run. Breaking ball fisted first base side and out of play, and it stays at 2-2.
If you're looking and wondering, have the Cajuns come back from five down this year to win? The answer is yes, one time, March the 11th at Louisiana Tech.
2-2 pitch, swing and a miss, struck him out. Fourth strikeout for Justin Gabriel, came out right at the eight-hole hitter Salo and got him on strikeouts. Here's Jason Kaiser. Make it five strikeouts for
Justin Gabriel.
Cowboys, number 11, shortstop, Jason Kaiser.
Kaiser at 310. 3 out of 9 against the Cajuns this year, 333. Rounded out toward Rick Heidel to end the second inning. Squares to bunt, gets it down first base side. Mazziotti fields, and the umpire at first base, home plate, Jim Jackson, rules it foul, and it's a good thing because Mazziotti threw it down the right field line. Mazziotti came out from behind home plate. The first bounce the ball took was in fair territory. And as Mazziotti came from behind the plate, it took one more hop right before he fielded it. That one was outside of the chalk, and Jim Jackson was right on top of it. Gabriel's ready, breaking ball, ground ball left side, underneath the glove of Nelson. Heidel knocks it down, but has no play. That's the seventh hit of the game for Mcneese, and the fourth hit for Kaiser off Cajun pitching this year. One out base runner, Nolan Parker, leadoff man in the Cowboy order, comes to the plate. Parker has hit 500 against the Cajuns this year, 5 out of 10. Singled, scored a run back in the third inning. Lefty, and a breaking ball from Gabriel is in for a strike. He's done a good job with the breaking ball. Fastball spotting has been a question mark at times for Gabriel through the first 3 1/3. And a snap throw to first, but Kaiser is back, and Kaiser is the biggest stolen base threat in this Mcneese club. He swiped 17 out of 18 this season. One time he was caught, it was by Danny Mazziotti here in the first game. 0-1 pitch, down low, ball on a strike. Feehan a couple of steps toward left in center field, and Hawkins toward the line. 5-0, Mcneese leads it, top half of the fourth inning. East Carolina beat Marist earlier in the day by a score of 12-3. Next pitch from Gabriel is in tight. And it's 2-2. Two hits for the Raging Cajuns thus far, singles in the second and third, but no runs to show for it. Look over at Kaiser again. Not a good move by Gabriel, just the show me move. Other Sun Belt teams, Florida International lost today to Florida Atlantic. 2-1 pitch, skied towards center. Feehan going back, now drifting, turns in front of the warning track, makes the catch for the second out of the inning. Deep fly ball off the bat of Parker. But Feehan got back on it well, and two outs for Stuart Landrell. South Alabama is over at the Starkville Regional. And last score we had on that one was Mississippi State 1 and South Alabama nothing. UL Monroe and New Orleans are playing over at Alex Box Stadium in Baton Rouge. We have not received a score on that one as of yet, but when we do, we'll pass it along. Landrino's 2 out of 2. Pitch out, nothing happening. Landrino doubled and scored in the first, singled and scored in the third. 4 out of 9 against Cajun pitching this season. And the 1-0 in the dirt, Mazziotti smothers it. And it's 2 balls and no strikes. Now this place seats a little over 3,200. And there are probably about 3,400 to 3,500 people here. These box seats are full. SRO tonight at Teague Moore. 2-0 pitch, can't get the change, and it's 2-1. Gabriel ready, kicks and fires, down low on a fastball. Mazziotti again has to dig it out of the dirt. The count goes to 3-1 on Landrino, who is a 333 hitter on the season. That double back in the first was his 15th of the season. Gabriel's 3-1 pitch. Checked to swing and took ball 4. And the Cowboys have him at first and second with two outs, and the Wrecking Crew again for the Cowboys has an opportunity to drive in a run. But two outs in the inning. Kevin Mitchell struck out in the first inning. Reached on Ryan Gill's error in the third, so now 0 for 10 against the Cajuns this year. But when he reached on that error, he drove in a run and also scored one. Pitch on the way. That one's hit up in the air toward left field. Sky high, but Hawkins has a beat on it and makes the catch, and the inning is over. So Justin Gabriel gives up a single and a walk. It gets out of the inning, and for the Cowboys in the fourth, no runs, a base hit, no errors. Two runners left on base after three and a half. It's the Cowboys 5, the Cajuns nothing.
At Hub City Ford, your volume discount dealer, we've waited, we've watched, and we've found the absolute best car buy of the year. We recently purchased over 100 program cars at huge volume discounts. We have the 99 Taurus or 99 Mercury Sable as low as $12,990 or zero down and $249 a month, all with remainder of factory warranty and low, low miles. If you can't tell the difference between a program car and a new car, then why pay the difference? At Hub City Ford, you get more car for less money, but when they're gone, they're gone. So hurry to Hub City Ford in Lafayette.
At Hops, we do whatever it takes to make your meal fresh and delicious.
Hey, I'm gonna show you boys how we fish.
I'm the bear.
Come to Papa, baby. You're not catching because you're not thinking. Fish on!
That's why Hops fresh seafood, Jamaican top sirloin, pastas, ribs, and microbrewed beers taste so great.
Tough day, huh? Tell me about it.
Hops restaurant, bar, and brewery located on Ambassador Caffrey between the mall and the river.
Hops, it's all good.
Hops!
Cajuns have been able to touch Chris Howie for a couple of hits and had him in some trouble in the third. Leadoff walk and then a hard hit ball that turned into a double play. Hit batsman and a base hit double steal. But Howie got out of it with a strikeout. So we go to the bottom of the fourth with the Cajuns on the short end of a 5-0 ball game. Danny Mazziotti will lead things off. Will Hawkins and Tommy Clark will follow as the Cajuns send 4, 5, and 6 to face Howie here in the last of the fourth inning.
Mazziotti led off the second inning with a fly ball to center field that Cormier took care of. 0-for-1 and 1-for-2 against the Cowboys this season. Mazziotti a year ago in the regional, 6 out of 21. And the first pitch is a fastball, and Mazziotti swings through it, strike one.
Mazziotti with that swing trying to get the Cajuns on the scoreboard. He had a big rip at a Howie fastball.
Big right-hander ready with the 0-1 upstairs on the fastball. And it's a ball and a strike. Mazziotti played in the game here at Moore Field early against the Cowboys, sat out the game at Cowboy Diamond in Lake Charles. And Mazziotti checks a swing at that one and fouls a pitch up and in back to the screen, and it's 1-2. That was when Danny was going through that thigh muscle problem. Roby Show sat him out of that game, and that thigh is still bothering a little bit, especially when he runs the bases. 1-2 pitch up and away, and it's 2-2. Mazziotti, a good base runner. He's stolen 6 out of 11, but he's been a non-factor since that injury. 2-2 pitch took something off, stayed high, and it's full up at 3-2.
Mazziotti is projected to go possibly in the first 5 rounds of the amateur draft next week.
And you're going to see a lot of Cajuns go in that draft. Here comes the full count pitch. Mazziotti might have swung a ball 4, and he fouls one toward the Cajun dugout.
You know, and that's unusual because Mazziotti leads this team in walks. He has many more walks than strikeouts this year and has been a very, very selective hitter. And it's a little unusual to see him chase something out of the zone.
Here's the payoff again. Down low, this one's crushed toward left center field. Back goes Parker, looking up. Can't get it, it's off his glove. Mazziotti around second. He's going for 3. Relay throw, not in time. Leadoff, triple for Danny Mazziotti. Third triple of the year for the Cajun catcher.
on most nights, that ball leaves Teague Moore Field. That one was belted.
Well, the second straight inning, the Cajuns have a runner at third base. This time, though, it's with nobody out. And here's Will Hawkins. Hawkins struck out in the second inning, nothing out of one. Two out of seven against the Cowboys this season. Both of those hits against Mcneese this year have been home runs. Third hit for the Cajuns, first for extra bases. Mcneese has a couple of doubles. 282 for Hawkins, 35 knocked in. First pitch is inside, gets away from the catch of Salo. Masiati trots home, and the score is 5-1. And that's going to be a pass ball charged to Josh Salo, his seventh of the year. So it's 5-1 as the Cajuns scratch for one here in the fourth. And Hawkins now has a totally different plan than he had when he stepped into the batter's box. Plan at that time, I'm sure, was to get Masiati home and just put that first run on the board. Tommy Clark waits on deck. As the third baseman, Rand Prince from Mcneese, came in, saw an obstruction in the crowd, and the home plate umpire took care of it. Hawkins can't get a high fastball, 1-1. Four doubles a year ago for Hawkins in the regional. As Howie misses down and away, and it's two balls and a strike.
Well, Howie now starting to fall behind the hitters just a tad here. And anybody who follows baseball knows it's easier to hit when they're pitching from behind.
2-1 pitch, down low, ground ball hit to the right side. Smothered by Landreau. In time to get Hawkins at first base by a couple of steps, and Tommy Clark comes to the plate. Hawkins swung at a pitch that was a couple of inches below his knees. Outside of the strike zone, and he probably wishes he had that at bat back. Well, Clark singled back in the second inning. It was the first Cajun hit of the ball game. Came with two outs. Three out of eight for Clark on the season against the Cowboys. Three runs scored and two knocked in. Down and in, a ball.
It's not been a great day for two seeds today at the regionals around the country. Several of them have gone down in this first round.
1-0 pitch, that's a fastball on the outside black, and it's 1-1. Clark has two extra base hits against the Cowboys this year, a homer and a double. Here's the 1-1. Up high, and it's 2-1. 5-1, Mcneese leads it. Bottom half of the fourth inning. Day one of the NCAA regionals. 2-1 pitch. That's a fastball, and it's a strike from Chris Hoey and a beauty. Here comes the 2-2 pitch. Popped up, right side, could be trouble. Foul territory, slicing toward the seats and out of play. And it stays at 2-2. Well, this is the guy that most of the 3,500 fans in attendance tonight need to thank for being here. It was Tommy Clark's at bat with two outs in the ninth inning against the Tulane Green Wave that wound up being a triple and helped the Cajuns tie the score. 2-2 pitch, fouled at the plate.
Next batter reached on an error. The Cajuns won that game 3-2. And when the regional sites were announced, one of the things that Dick Rockwell, chairman of the selection committee, talked about was the Cajun sweep over Tulane. They won in New Orleans 12-1. Was one of the primary factors that a regional is in Lafayette and is not in New Orleans. So this is the Tommy Clark Regional.
2-2 pitch. This one's hit in the air toward left center. Converging are Cormier and Parker, and it's the left fielder Parker who makes the catch for out number two. Parker, a guy who certainly has the ability to get drafted. Left fielder, runs well, hits for a high average, has the ability to drive the ball up the gap.
And hits from the left side. They always like it when you hit from the left side.
Poche's the hitter for the Cajuns, struck out back in the second inning, and he fouls the first pitch back out of play and off one of the light standards here. And it comes back into the seats behind the first base dugout. Poche, 2 out of 7 against the Cowboys this year. Was 2 for 2 with a couple of RBIs in the regional last year. Pitch down low, and the ball count as a ball and a strike. It came in, as you might expect, very limited playing time. Jeff Robinson was the Cajuns' first baseman last year. And he had a pretty good tournament down in Houston as well. 1-1 pitch. Sticks his bat out, loops one to center. Here comes Cormier, the center fielder, under it and makes the catch for the third out of the inning. But the Cajuns finally scratch for one. They get a run on a triple by Danny Mazziotti and a pass ball. One hit in the inning, no errors, and nobody left on base. We've played four, it's the Cowboys 5, and the Cajuns 1 at the NCAA Regional in Lafayette.
Church's Chicken. It's what made from scratch should taste like. Come in now and try 6 spicy, crispy Church's Buffalo Wings with fries, only $1.99.
In the 90s, LSU baseball was called the program of the decade. Watch Skip Berkman's Tigers dominate a new era.
Sunday at 1 on KLAF.
UPN Monday is really cooking.
Hey!
We're serving it up.
Would you care for some coffee, tea, and sweeten it with me?
Spicing it up.
Garlic, pepper.
And if you can't take the heat,
you didn't even taste it.
I didn't have to. It winked at me.
Stay out of the kitchen.
To microwave the turkey, do I press the chicken button 3 times?
It's Moesha, the Barkers, grown-ups, and Malcolm and Eddie.
Monday, starting at 7 on KLAF.
Only one show has the biggest stars, the most beautiful women, and all the episodes.
Hey, Dennis.
Ah! Shasta returns.
Tuesday at 7 on KLAF.
Top half of the fifth inning, and Mcneese State will send up Williamson, Prince, and Cormier to face Justin Gabriel. As you on TV take a look at the Cajun Heartland State Fair, we've also going to give you all of the scores from all of the regionals during this half inning.
Williamson swings at the first offering from Gabriel, a breaking ball, can't get it, nothing and one. Williamson, 1 out of 2 in the evening, doubled in a run and scored a run. 5 hits in 9 trips against the Raging Cajuns this season. 0-1 pitch, another breaking ball, and Gabriel is offering Williamson a healthy dose. The last 5 pitches Williamson has seen from Gabriel have all been breaking balls. 0-2 pitch, swing and a miss, strike 3. So Gabriel has fanned Williamson for the second time this ball game. 6 strikeouts for Williamson, and here's Prince.
In the Columbia, South Carolina regional, Wake Forest beat Seton Hall earlier today, 8-3. The number one national seed, South Carolina, is in a battle with Liberty. 4-4, bottom of the 7th. Up in Minneapolis, Nebraska beat Butler 2-1. Minnesota leads Wichita State 2-1, top of the 3rd inning.
Prince is 2-for-2. A breaking ball from Gabriel just misses outside. A ball and no strikes. 2 RBIs for Prince as well on the evening. Gabriel works quickly. 1-0. Strike on the outside corner.
In Palo Alto, Alabama beat Nevada 8-2. Fresno State and Stanford a little bit later.
1-1 pitch. Outside 2-1.
Over in Houston, Rice beat Texas Tech 5-2. And Houston leads Princeton 4-0, top of the 6th inning.
2-1. Change up, down and away, and Gabriel's behind in the count, 3-1.
San Jose State upset Florida 4-1 today over in Waco, Texas. Southwest Texas State and Baylor are scoreless, bottom of the 4th.
3-1 pitch, fouled back, 3-2.
Notre Dame beat Tulane today 8-4. Mississippi State leads South Alabama 4-2, bottom of the seventh inning. That is in Starkville.
Fans asking for the seventh strikeout from Justin Gabriel. 3-2 pitch, line off of Gabriel, ricochets toward Gill. Fields throws, got it.
That is a major league play.
A line drive off the glove of Justin Gabriel. In fact, it separated Gabriel's hand from the glove. Ricocheted directly toward Ryan Gill, who charged hard, fielded and fired underhand all in one motion just to get a diving Rand Prince at first base by about a half inch. Just a wonderful play by Ryan Gill.
That's a close play at first base.
And here's Doug Cormier. Pitch on the way, a breaking ball drops in for strike one. Cormier, nothing out of one, a sack fly back in the third.
In Clemson, South Carolina, Illinois defeated Old Dominion 3-1. Clemson leads Middle Tennessee 3-0 top of the eighth.
Next pitch from Gabriel's a fastball in for a strike, and it's 0-2.
Over in Baton Rouge, LSU beat Jackson State 19-1. Louisiana Monroe leads New Orleans 4-2 in the top of the fourth inning.
0-2 pitch, here it comes, breaking ball in the dirt.
Over in Oklahoma City, UCLA got three in the ninth to beat Delaware 13-12. Oral Roberts and Oklahoma are scoreless bottom of the second. In Tempe, Arizona, Texas beat Creighton 5-4. Miami of Ohio and Arizona State later.
1-2 pitch, a little bit low, and the count goes to 2-2.
In Coral Gables, Florida, Florida Atlantic beat Florida International 14-6. Miami leads Wagner 11-3, bottom of the sixth.
Here's the 2-2, up and away, full count.
In Tallahassee, Central Florida beat Evansville 4-1. Florida State leads Bethune-Cookman 5-2, bottom of the sixth. In Fullerton, California, Southern Cal beat Virginia Tech 8-3. Loyola Marymount and Cal State Fullerton coming up later.
Here's the payoff. 3-2 fouled back toward the screen. We'll do it again.
In Atlanta, Stetson upset Auburn 9-5. Georgia Tech leads Georgia Southern 7-4, top of the fifth. And in Upper Montclair, New Jersey, Rutgers defeated Army 4-3. And North Carolina leads Penn State 5-1, bottom of the fourth, and you're caught up.
Big hand for Jay Walker. 3-2 pitch again, hit in the air, left center field. Feehan was played in the right center gap, but he comes over, makes the catch, and the side is retired. That is just the second 1-2-3 inning for Justin Gabriel here in the ballgame. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left on base. We'll go to the bottom of the fifth. It's the Cowboys 5, and the Cajuns 1.
Too firm? Too soft? Then get a Spring Air mattress for both comfort and support. Spring Air, the mattress with the just right feeling.
You too can sleep like a bear every night with the Spring Air Back Supporter Mattress from Anderson Wholesale Furniture. Go by Anderson Furniture today and see their Spring Air Gallery. Spring Air, the mattress with the just right feeling. Anderson Furniture, 122 South Buchanan Street.
Church's Chicken. It's what made from scratch should taste like. Come in now and try six spicy, crispy Church's Buffalo Wings with fries, only $1.99.
Bottom half of the fifth inning. We're halfway through this one. And the Cajuns trailing by the score of 5-1. They'll send up Scott Atwood, Rick Heidel on the top of the order, Stephen Feehan to face Chris Howie, who's given up just three hits through the first four innings. And the Cowboys, with seven hits in the game, have a four-run lead.
Atwood drew a leadoff walk back in the third inning and then was part of that 6-4-3 double play on a hard shot off the bat by Rick Heidel. Big right-handed hitter. Pitch on the way, cuts on the first pitch, can't get it, strike one. Very windy day earlier this afternoon. Wind blowing in directly from center field while Marist and East Carolina were playing. But the flag this evening is fairly limp in center field, despite the fact that there's still a pretty decent breeze that's blowing through the grandstand here. Howie is ready, and it's nothing and two as he throws a changeup to Atwood, and Scott was just totally fooled on that one. Now he's down on the count, nothing and two, and Howie just misses on the outside corner with a fastball to move the count to one and two. Atwood leading off the fifth, takes ball two of high. Heidel and Feehan. Just three hits in the game for the Cajuns. This one's popped up, foul territory. Back goes the catcher, Salo, and that one's into the seats. Three hits for the Cajuns have been stretched out in between three innings. A single in the second, a single in the third, a triple by Mazziotti leading off the fourth, and Danny scored the only run of the game for the Cajuns. Open stance for Atwood. 2-2 on the way. Fister, right field. Could be trouble. Here comes Guillory. Diving. Can't get it. He's by him. Atwood rounds first hard. Throw comes in very quickly as the second baseman, Landreneau, made a hustle play in right field to get the ball that had gotten by Guillory. And Atwood went diving back into first base as the throw came into second.
Yeah, and that's a nice job by Anthony Babineau screaming at Atwood to put those brakes on. So the Cajuns have the lead man on for the third straight inning. Last time a double play hurt. Well, actually the first time they had the lead man on, a double play hurt. Last time they were able to score a run.
Rick Heidel hit into that double play in the third inning. A hard one hopper right to the shortstop, Kaiser. He fired to Landreneau, and then the second baseman wheeled over to first. So Heidel nothing out of one, and there's a called strike on the outside corner. Heidel, first team all-conference shortstop in the Sun Belt. 0-1 pitch, a bluff by Atwood at first, and the pitch is down low, a ball. And that was a bit of a surprise to some people. A lot of people believe that Sammy Cooper out of New Orleans was the best shortstop in the league.
Well, statistically he was, but coaches vote in this all-conference team, and we'll tell you how they vote.
1-1 pitch, change up down and in.
They don't sit there and pore over statistics like us in the media do. They say, what did this guy do against me? And there were four teams in the league that Rick Heidel absolutely murdered. And as a result, he got those coaches' votes and wound up the all-conference shortstop.
1-2 as Heidel cut on and missed that change up from Howie. And the pitch is hit down the third baseline inside the bag. That's extra bases. Atwood rounding second. He's on his way to third. Parker's having trouble in left. Semino's going to wave Atwood. The relay will not come to the plate, and it's 5-2. RBI double for Rick Heidel, and Atwood scores all the way from first base as Parker, who has only played in this ballpark one time during his career, had all sorts of problems with the box seats down the left field line as the ball ricocheted around, and it's 5-2. RBI number 33 for Rick Heidel. And Semino was waving at Wood the whole way.
That's going to bring Mike Bianco out of the Mcneese State dugout to have a word with Howie. It does not appear that there's any warm-up activity down on the Mcneese State bullpen as of yet, however. So this is just a courtesy call. And for those of you who are, you're getting a good look at Bianco if you're watching on television. And this is pretty much a settle them down type of conversation.
Well, you had Mike Bianco on your show the other day on Bird's Eye View. And he sounded eerily similar to Skip Bertman
at
times.
Didn't he? The way he answered questions, almost his cadence.
The way he pronounced certain words.
Uh-huh.
Eerily similar to Skip Bertman, and that's probably because, one, he coached with him for a long time, and two, he was in on a lot of those conversations at the mound. He was, of course, a catcher for LSU in 88 and 89, played in the College World Series with the Tigers one year. Well, it's 5-2. Bianco's back in the dugout. Nobody out. Heidel at second and Feehan at the plate. And Howie with an inside spin and a look toward Heidel at second. Feehan, nothing out of one, grounded out, hit by a pitch, and he's stolen a base. 3 out of 7 against the Pokes this season. Howie, pitch, up and in, a ball to Feehan.
And for the first time tonight, Kyle, the crowd is into the game, and I don't know if this affects the Cajuns as much as it might affect Mcneese State. Of course, they've played in Baton Rouge this year. They know what it's like to play before big crowds.
And won in Baton Rouge. These Cowboys swept the season series from LSU. And played a lot of other people who are in NCAA regionals very closely. Howie steps off. Feehan steps out. They're both ready again, and here we go. 1-0 count for the Cajun center fielder. And that's a strike at the knees in the inside corner, 1-1. Well, Howie Flatt made a mistake there. The catcher, Salo, was set up on the outside corner. He threw one on the inside corner and got it over for a strike. Feehan is the first Cajun in baseball history to play in 4 NCAA regionals. 1-1. Down low, and it's 2 balls and a strike as Feehan bluffed a bunt.
And that's a tribute to Tony Robichaud, because this is the first time the Cajuns have ever appeared in 4 consecutive NCAA regionals. And the bar is getting raised here. Fans now expect the Cajuns to be in regional play, and they expect them to get into regionals and win some games.
2-1 count to Feehan. Howie comes to the plate with a pitch, fouled off right side, out of play, and back on to Reinhardt Drive. Rick Heidel, an RBI double down the left field line, has pulled the Cajuns to within 3 runs of Mcneese. Cowboys scored 2 in the first, 3 in the third. Justin Gabriel for the Cajuns is starting to settle a bit. Yeah, just a second 1-2-3 inning back in the fifth. Trying to get some offense from his mates now. Howie's 2-2 outside, and it's 3-2. And this is a dangerous position right now for Chris Howie. A walk here to Feehan puts him at first and second, nobody out, with Gil Nelson and Mazziotti to follow. Hill in the on-deck circle, asking the crowd for encouragement. Here comes the pitch. Check swing, ground ball right side. Landrino charges, throws to first. Nice play. Heidel goes to third on the ground out.
But he gets to third with just one out, and Feehan does a nice job. Hit the ball to the right side, and although he was thrown out, he did advance the runner, so the Cajuns have a chance for a 2-run inning here if Gill can come through right here.
Ryan Gill, the senior out of Baton Rouge, playing in his second NCAA regional. 1 out of 2 tonight, singled, stole a base in the third, and grounded back to the box in the first. 3 doubles and a triple a year ago in postseason play. And the pitch, check swing, ground ball, right side. This is Williamson, but there's no place in Gill at first base. And in to score is Rick Heidel from third. A check swing, kind of in the area where you might see a push bunt happen.
Yeah, and the problem was Howie never got off the mound.
So that'll be a single and an RBI for Ryan Gill. The second baseman, Landrino, went for the ball. Williamson, the first baseman, cut him off. And as Jay mentioned, Howie never got to first base. And now it's 5-3.
And now the tying run is at the plate with one out.
And it's in the form of one of the best hitters in Cajun baseball history, Nathan Nelson. Nothing out of 2 tonight, a 371 hitter for the year. And a check of Gill at first, who is 18 out of 26. Now 19 out of 27 in stolen bases this year. Nelson has knocked in a club leading 40. Howie delivers to Nelson, and he chops one foul down the third base side, and it's 0-1. And the crowd is certainly into this one now as the Cajuns have clawed back from a 5-0 deficit and turned this into a 2-run ball game. Howie is ready from the stretch. 0-1. Roof. Left field. That's going to drop. That's a base hit. Gill rounding second. Racing for third. Ball misplayed in the outfield by Parker. Seminole's going to wave Gill. No relay throw. His pitch drops it at third and it's 5-4. And Nelson pulling the second with a double. That's going to be a double for Nathan Nelson. An error on the left field to Parker to allow Gill to score. Nelson got one off the end of the bat, but had the bat head outside of the ball and just looped it down the left field line. Gill was rolling the whole way toward third, and Parker overran the ball and left.
Yeah, charged Parker with an error, allowing the run to score. No RBI for Nelson, but credit him with his 14th double of the year. And now the Cajuns are one base hit away from tying this up.
Well, the Cajuns now have a 3-run inning of their own as they put up a crooked number here in the 5th inning. And it's not over yet. Just one out, and Dane Asiati comes to the plate. Asiati, one out of two in the night. Fly to center back in the second inning. Tripled leading off the fourth and scored on a pass ball.
Little base hit from Atwood. A bouncing ball down the line by Heidel. A check swing single by Gill and a bloop by Nelson. They all count, though.
A spin and a look towards second. Nelson not going anywhere. Only a couple of steps from the bag. Nelson leads this team in stolen bases by 9. 28 of them this season. And Masiati wants time.
And if you're wondering, is the 28 a Cajun record? No, but it's about halfway to one.
Not even close. Joe Burnett.
52 one year.
Now he's ready. Pitch to Masiati. Up and in. Masiati ducks out of the way of a hard one from Chris Howie, and it's a ball and no strikes. 1-run ball game here from Teague Moore Field in Lafayette. And this one has all the makings of a thriller. Howie's ready from the stretch. Here it comes, up and in. That's two balls and no strikes.
And now if you're wondering, would Nelson try to steal third? Of course, if you get him to third with one out, there are all sorts of ways to get him home. And if you're wondering, down a run, should you? I'll remind everybody, Nelson has a green light. Nelson is one of a couple of Cajuns that doesn't wait for a signal to try to steal.
2-0 pitch. That's inside at the knees on Masiati, and it's three balls and no strikes. Will Hawkins, a dangerous hitter for the Cajuns, waits on deck.
Now, if Howie walks Masiati, I'll guarantee you they'll start the runners then. They'll try to get the double steal to get him to second and third.
Activity now in the Cowboy bullpen as Howie comes to the plate, grooves the pitch right down Broadway, and it's three balls and a strike. Howie from the stretch, kicks and fires. All four. Missed outside on the fastball, and they're at first and second now with one out. And Howie, who has given up 3 already in this inning, not nearly out of the woods yet. In fact, still a couple of Redwoods in front of him in the form of Hawkins and Clark. Hawkins is nothing out of two, a strikeout, a ground out. But I remind you that it's two base hits against the Cowboys this year, or both home runs. Right-handed hitter out of Houston, Texas. Pitch on the way, chopped toward third. Prince has it. Goes to second. Relay to first. Not in time. Prince thought about trying to tag Nathan Nelson, who put on the brakes in between second and third.
That's a nice job by Nelson there.
And that probably saved a double play. So he erased Maziotti on the force, 5-4. Hawkins on with a fielder's choice. Now they're at first and third. And if Mike Bianco's done his homework, he knows that the Cajuns will try to steal that run.
Now the runner at third is Nelson, who has stolen home this year. Now Howie is going to go from the stretch, and that's a very smart move.
Clark is one out of two in the ninth. And that hit him. Second hit batter in the ball game for Chris Howie, and now they're loaded for Jess Poche.
Well, Poche has ended two innings for the Cajuns already tonight. He's the ninth man to bat in the inning.
Poche ended the second with a strikeout. Ended the fourth with a fly out towards center. Two out of eight against the Pokes this season. He has yet to drive in a run against Mcneese. But he's knocked in 29 this season, and he has all sorts of power. Pretty much a dead fastball hitter. Pitch on the way. That's a breaking ball and a strike on the outside corner. Poche, the sophomore out of Hester, Louisiana. Hoey's done his homework because he's thrown a healthy dose of breaking stuff to Poche tonight. Here's the 0-1 pitch. Another one line toward right. Hillary goes back in front of the warning track, reaches up and makes the catch, and the Cajuns leave them loaded in the fifth inning. But they turn a five-run deficit into a one-run ball game as they get three runs in the inning. They do it on four base hits, no Cowboy, make it one Cowboy error. Three runners left on base. The Cajuns have stranded 6-5, and it's the Cowboys 5, the Raging Cajuns 4.
It's time for Slimco's 63rd annual membership meeting this coming Saturday at the Cajun Dome. Every Slimco member is invited. Admission is free. Doors open at 6 a.m. Richard LaBeouf and Two Step kick off the music at 6:30. Over two dozen door prizes will be given, plus 20 college scholarships. And one lucky Slimco member will win the grand prize, a new car or truck from Lafayette Motors. Public Service Commissioner Jimmy Field will be the guest speaker. It's all over before noon. Come to Slimco's 63rd annual membership meeting this Saturday at the Cajun Dome.
Hello, Acadiana. It's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi. I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a five-year warranty. Or a brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a five-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
We'll go to the sixth inning. Cajuns have closed to within one at 5-4. Bottom third of the batting order for Mcneese State. Guillory, Salo, and Kaiser to face Justin Gabriel. And a big inning here, Kyle, for the Cajuns. They've got the momentum now. Now Gabriel's got to go out and make sure Mcneese doesn't get it back.
Guillory leads things off. He's nothing out of two, and the first pitch is in for a strike. Jay's exactly right. This is the time of game where a coach tells his pitcher, go back out there and get us in the dugout quickly. Nothing and two to Guillory. Gabriel has taken heed of that suggestion. And he's ahead in the count. 0-2 pitch fouled back toward the screen on a change, and it stays at nothing and two. Three runs in the fifth inning for the Cajuns on four hits. Hits are now even at seven apiece as Gabriel comes to the plate down low, and it's a ball and two strikes. One-two pitch down low again on a breaking ball, and it's 2-2, and we welcome those listening on Sports Radio ESPN 1420 and those watching the ball game on KLAF TV, cable channel 17. 2-2 pitch down and in. And it's full up to Guillory. So Gabriel got up in the count to the bar product, nothing and two, and now it's 3-2. Here's the payoff pitch. Hit up in the air, left center field. Hawkins toward the gap. Makes the catch, and there's one gone. Five in a row now for Justin Gabriel.
Number nine, Josh Sallow.
And here's Josh Sallow. Gabriel's had his way with the poke catcher tonight. Caught him looking at a called third strike in the second inning. Got him swinging in the fourth. Gabriel has punched out six tonight. Pitch on the way. Inside, and it's a ball and no strikes. Down low a ball, and it's 2-0. Cowboys have an awful lot of players on their roster from the Lake Charles area and surrounding. This one's hit toward right center field. Could be trouble. Clark going back in front of the warning track. Makes a nice over-the-shoulder catch on a run, and there's two gone. Bottom of the order, Jason Kaiser. Gabriel's retired six in a row. And he's trying to get the Cajuns back in the dugout after they scored three runs in the fifth. Trying to keep that momentum that they have through the last couple of innings. And the first pitch to Kaiser is up and in, ball one. A strike. Eleven players on the Mcneese roster as Gabriel grooves another one, and it's 1-2. 11 players are from outside of the state of Louisiana. 10 more are from Calcasieu Parish, and there's strike three as Kaiser chased a breaking ball out of the dirt, tried to check the swing but couldn't. Gabriel spans seven in the game, and he's retired seven in a row. No runs, no hits, no errors. Nobody left on base for the Cowboys in the sixth. On our way to the bottom of the sixth inning from Teague Moore Field, and it's the Cowboys 5, UL 4.
We learn at a very early age one of life's most important lessons, that we all possess the power of choice. And as we grow, every choice becomes more important. Deciding who provides our health care may be the most important choice of all. For it is here at Lafayette General that our children are mended, mothers and fathers grow stronger, our hopes are sustained, life takes on its greatest meaning. Lafayette General Medical Center. Your health, your hospital, your choice.
Has your home phone been disconnected? ComSouth can get you talking again for just $49. Owe another phone company money? We'll hook you up for only $49. That's right. You can get unlimited local calls and 911 emergency access now for just $49 a month. No deposit, no credit, no ID. Just $49 for your first month's service. Don't be without a home phone, and don't pay more than $49. Call our local agent to join ComSouth now.
Bottom half of the sixth inning here at Teague Moore Field, and we've seen a definite change in the momentum of this game. Cajuns trailed 5-0. They have come back to 5-4. They've gotten the crowd in the game, and they'll send up Atwood, Heidel, and Feehan to face Howie here in the bottom of the sixth.
Atwood will lead off an inning for the third time in the last four innings. Walked in the third, was erased in a double play, singled and scored, leading off the fifth. And Howie's first pitch is a ball, and it's 1-0. Atwood at 210. Big right hander ready with the pitch. This one's popped up, foul territory, over toward the Cajun dugout. A Sallow looking up, and that's in the seats. An outstanding play made by a guy in the third row of the box seats.
That's a guy in a tan shirt?
No, the guy right next to him in the gray shirt. Almost looks like Gerald Apert, doesn't it? And if it is, that might explain something. 1-1 count to Atwood. That's a breaking ball, and it's high, and it's 2-1. Dell and Feehan to follow here in the sixth inning. Pitch on the way. That one stayed high, and it's 3-1. Cowboys trying to fend off a furious Cajun rally over the last two innings. It was 5-0 going to the bottom of the fourth inning. Howie delivers, popped up, foul territory again. Third baseman Prince comes over, gives it a look, but that one's well out of play, and that ball was hit a mile in the air. And it's full count to Scott Atwood. Transfer out of North Florida Junior College, one of the top JUCO programs in the Southeast. Now he's ready. Payoff. Popped up again. This one's on the infield and in fair territory. Pitcher Howie. Catcher Salo. Salo can't get it as the ball comes back toward foul territory. About 10 feet out of play. Got no communication there at all. Salo couldn't find it off the bat. Howie looked like he had a pretty good look at it. The first baseman Williamson was nowhere to be found.
And meanwhile, Scott Atwood is saying thank you very much. Scott, if you keep popping them up, sooner or later they will catch one.
Still at full count. Howie and Atwood leading off the sixth. Pitch on the way. Pop this one up, and that one goes back out of play. He would do it at 3-2 for the third time. Now he wants a new baseball. Wasn't satisfied with the one that home plate umpire Jim Jackson threw out there. Gets one and goes to the rosin bag one time. Now he's ready to go as Atwood digs in. Open stance, big right-handed hitter. Payoff pitch. Popped up, back out of play. Atwood fouling off some pretty good pitches from Chris Hoey. Ready again. Here it comes up and in, and Atwood draws a leadoff walk. Well, Atwood has been to the plate three times in this game. All of them were leading off innings, and he's reached every time. The first time, Rick Heidel grounded into a double play. The second time, Atwood doubled down the left field line, and Atwood scored all the way from first.
Be interesting to see here if Tony Robichaud tries to go ahead and bunt the runner over and goes ahead and tries to get this thing tied up here this inning. Of course, hit and run's a possibility, but Heidel strikes out a lot. And of course, he hit into a double play his first time up.
Adell at 281. An RBI back in the fifth was his 33rd of the season. Howie is ready. Adell does square the bunt, gets it down. It'll be the pitcher Howie over to first base to Williamson in time. Sacrifice successful, 1-3. And Atwood's in scoring position for Stephen Feehan, who is hitless on the night. 0-2. He has reached. He was hit by a pitch in the third inning, stole a base, and did a good job in the fifth with Heidel down at second base to hit a ground ball to the right side of the infield. That got Heidel over to third. And Gill was able to drive in Heidel with an infield single to the right side. So here's Feehan, 326. Pitch on the way, it bounces at about 58 feet and blocked by Salo.
For the tournament, 3,200 is capacity here at Teague Moore Field. Of course, a lot of seats have been taken out by auxiliary press area and whatnot. Well, they missed by 40. 3,160 is the crowd here this evening at the Teague. Although I don't know where they put 40 more people, I got to tell you.
One out, runner down at second. It's the tying run for the Cajuns. Feehan lifts one back of second base. Landreneau, the second baseman, comes out. Guillory comes in. It's the right fielder, Guillory, making the catch for the second out of the inning. And Feehan goes back to the dugout 0 for 3. Now Ryan Gill is 2 out of 3 on the night. Singled, stole a base in the third, and had a check swing RBI single in the fifth. And there was communication problems between Williamson, Landreneau, and Howie.
That's 28 multiple hit games for Gill this year. And this, the Cajuns' 60th game of the year. So in almost half of them, he's had two hits or more.
Hits at 353. Which is second in the Cajun club behind Nelson. Pitch on the way, down in the dirt. Sallow again with a nice job behind the dish, keeping it in front.
Of the 28 multiple hits that games that Gill have had, seven of those games have been three hits or more.
A three-hit game would be nice right now for Ryan Gill, because it would likely get that run home from second. Howie with a long look, and Gill's had enough.
Well, Atwood was really had his attention because he was a good 25 feet off the bag down at second base.
And of course, the middle infielders in this situation won't hold him very much to open up an alley. Here's the pitch. This one's hit up the right center field gap. They're going to be tied. Gill rounds first, on his way to second. Gill can fly. Round second, relay to third, sliding in safe is Ryan Gill with the Cajuns' second triple of the game, and we're knotted at five. Triple number three for Ryan Gill. Second RBI of the night. He's got 37 from the season. And Gill might have gotten hit in the head with the baseball in the relay. He has his helmet off, sitting on the third base bag. The trainer, David Bork, has come out. The relay came in from the shortstop, Kaiser, on the tandem back of second base. The throw was a strong one toward third. Prince never got a glove on the ball. It trickled a couple of feet away from the third base bag. And the training staff is out taking a look at the Cajun senior.
Boy, was that ball hit. That is the fifth time this year. The fifth time this year that Gill has had three hits in a game. In the meantime, Mcneese is going to change pitchers as lefty Patrick Stark is going to come in. That means we can go ahead and take a commercial break right here. And we will do that and come back to Teague Moore Field. We're 5-5, the Cajuns and the Cowboys, back right after this.
Refreshingly roomy Accord from Honda, the Accord for the year 2000.
Now get special APR financing as low as 3.9% for 36 months on new four-cylinder Accords.
UPN Monday is really cooking.
Hey!
We're serving it up.
Would you care for some coffee, tea, and sweeten it with me?
Spicing it up. Can't take the heat.
You didn't even taste it.
I didn't have to. It winked at me.
Stay out of the kitchen.
To microwave the turkey, do I press the chicken button three times?
It's Moesha, the Barkers, Grown-Ups, and Malcolm and Eddie.
Monday, starting at 7 on KLAF.
On the season, Stark has walked 26 and struck out 29. Chris Howie leaves after going 5 2/3 innings. Gave up 8 hits and 5 runs. He walked a couple and hit a couple. And he struck out a couple. So he gives way to Stark here. Stark against the Cajuns, two appearances, five and a third innings, three hits, three runs, all of them unearned. Two walks and five strikeouts. He's pitched effectively against the Cajuns, although Louisiana is a team that hits left-handers very well, and this guy hits lefties better than all of them. He's over 500 this year against left-handed pitching.
It's Nathan Nelson who comes to the plate, one out of three on the evening. Pitch on the way, hit up in the air right field. Guillory back a couple of steps in the gap, makes the catch on the side, is retired, but the Cajuns scratch for another run. They've scored in three straight innings, the RBI triple by Ryan Gill. For the Cajuns in the sixth inning, they get a run on a base hit. No Mcneese errors and one runner left on base. The Cajuns have stranded seven through six, but we're tied as we head to the seventh.
Introducing the most responsive and exciting sports luxury sedan in America, the 2000 BMW 528i from Moss BMW. All-season traction, dynamic stability control, roadside assistance, and three-year scheduled maintenance, a few details that make this automobile a best overall value of the year. And right now, you can lease this new 2000 BMW 528 sedan loaded for only $528 per month, but only at Moss BMW, 1401 Surrey Street, Lafayette, or visit us at www.mossisboss.com.
Let's get her.
Excuse me, miss. Hi, hey, gang. You wear contacts?
Yeah.
Yeah, you get the lowest price in sight?
I pay two something.
Oh, too much. Why do you come with me and bring these kids?
See, at America's Best, you get a complete doctor's eye exam and two six-packs of soft med disposable contacts, all for just $59.99. Hey, this is America's Best.
Absolutely.
Or you get one doggone good deal.
Hey.
Sorry. Call 1-800-2-PAIR to discover the lowest price in sight. 1-800-2-PAIR.
Five runs for the Cowboys through the first three, none for the Cajuns. Five runs for the Cajuns through the middle three, none for the Cowboys. We're knotted at five as we head to the top of the seventh inning. Parker, Landrino, and Mitchell. Jay, I have erased your inefficiencies. It's all on you, Jack.
That's your best performance in a couple of years. Parker leads off and takes a pitch inside for ball one. Parker's one for three tonight. Singled and scored in the third inning. There's a ground ball. Poche is able to get a glove on it. Gill goes to Gabriel. Oh, my, what a play. Poche diving, deflected it to Gill. Gabriel off the mound to cover, and there's one out.
Well, we've watched Ryan Gill tonight display pure athleticism is what we've done. He hit the ball at the right center field gap. You had a chance to watch the speed, the ball that was hit off Gabriel a couple of innings ago. You had an opportunity to watch him charge a ball and throw off balance. That time he was headed toward first, stopped at a dime, and came back to get the baseball. So he's showing all the skills tonight.
Here's Stuart Landrino. He's been on base three times this evening, and he takes a pitch low for ball one. Doubled and scored in the first, singled and scored in the third, and then walked in the fourth. That ball is hit a mile high in the air and deep. Feehan goes back, and that ball is off the wall. Landrino is on his way to third, and he will be in with a triple. That breaks a string of eight in a row, retired by Gabriel. In fact, the last man to reach was Landrino, who had walked. And he didn't miss a home run by much.
Now, Feehan misjudged that one a little bit off the bat, but that one was smoked. It was over his head anyway, and he went back so hard to try to make up for that mistake at the beginning that the ball hit the bottom of the wall, and by that time, he had kind of overran the baseball. It bounced back, ricocheted past him again. He had to track it down another 25 feet back toward the infield, and Landrino was able to get around. But going back to that play a moment ago off Poche's glove to Ryan Gill, give Gabriel a lot of credit for not giving up on that play as well.
Pitch down low to Keith Mitchell for ball one. He has struck out, reached down an error, and flied to left. 0 for 3, but he scored one and knocked one in. Check swing there, and he was badly fooled, and the count is 1-1. Well, South Carolina came back and got him. They beat Liberty by the score of 6-4. Minnesota leads Wichita State 7-3, bottom of the fifth. 1-1 pitch. Outside, two balls and a strike. Princeton over Houston, 6-2, top of the seventh. They checked down with the first base umpire. They said he swung. So make the count, a ball and two strikes. Southwest Texas State leads Baylor 1-0, top of the seventh. Mississippi State beats South Alabama 9-2. Swing and a miss, he got him. Number seven, make it number eight in the game for Gabriel, and now there are two outs for the dangerous Williamson coming up. Williamson doubled home a run and scored in the first, struck out in the third and again in the fifth. The RBI in the first inning, his 70th of the year. And the first pitch, breaking ball down in the dirt, gets away from Mazziotti, but rolls up the third baseline. There'll be no advance, one ball and no strikes.
And you know, people talk about not getting the runner home from third with less than two outs being a real killer for your baseball team. But when it happens in late innings in baseball games like this, where you have a tight ball game, you have one team that has all the momentum, one run like that can change the momentum. It's not very difficult. A triple by Stuart Landreneau with one out in the inning. And if Mitchell can get that run home, the momentum, even though the Cajuns have scored five runs over the last three innings, the momentum switches just because of one run. And now with the fact that they are unable to get that runner home from third, it gives the Cajuns another chance to breathe, and it gives Gabriel a chance to bring out his whole assortment of pitches again.
Clemson has beaten Middle Tennessee 4-0. Louisiana Monroe is leading New Orleans 7-3, bottom of the seventh. Oral Roberts in Oklahoma 1-1, bottom of the fourth. Miami over Wagner 18-5. Bottom of the eighth. Stretched by Gabriel, and now they're going to walk him. They'll put him on intentionally. And this will be the first walk that Justin Gabriel has given up tonight. And they'll take their chances with Rand Prince, who's got a couple of hits tonight. Florida State has beaten Bethune-Cookman 6-3. Georgia Tech leads Georgia Southern 11-8, top of the ninth, and North Carolina over Penn State 18-3. In the bottom of the sixth. Make that 8-3 in the bottom of the sixth inning. So you're caught up in the regionals. Williamson walks. And here is Prince. Singled home a run in the first and again in the third, and then hit that hard shot off of Gabriel that deflected to Gill, and Gill was able to throw him out. So Prince has hit it hard three times. Robichaud will walk the lefty to get to the righty, although Williamson, without question, is the more dangerous hitter of the two. But at least in this game, Prince has been very, very good. So a big spot for Gabriel here in the seventh inning. Hits are even in the game at eight. As a matter of fact, the line scores are even in this game. 5-8-1 for both teams. There is warm-up activity in the Cajun bullpen. And here comes Robichaud. And he will go ahead and make the change here. And my guess is it's going to be the big right-hander, Gordon O'Brien. So Gabriel is lifted with two out in the seventh. He goes 6 2/3. Cannot win it, but could lose it. But he'll give way now to a new pitcher. We've got a pitching change. That means a commercial break. And we're back right after this timeout.
Southside Honda says thanks to Cajuns for helping our business grow. At our new location, we're bigger and better than ever. Our showroom has a wide selection of new Hondas, from street bikes to dirt bikes and off-road ATVs. We may be larger, but we still offer the same great service and quality. Come discover the excitement at Southside Honda, open Monday through Saturday, with extended hours Wednesday and Thursday till 9. That's Southside Honda, next to Giles on Johnston Street.
Acadiana, it's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi. I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a 5-year warranty. Or a brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a 5-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
Pin this year. Gordon O'Brien, a couple of saves for the Raging Cajuns, 26 2/3 innings, 20 hits, 15 runs, 10 earned, 49 strikeouts, 18 walks. Opponents hit 196 against him.
The whole thing here with Tony Robichaud making the move that he did. was he decided he'd rather have O'Brien pitching to Prince than Gabriel pitching to Williamson. Now, O'Brien is a strikeout pitcher, 49 strikeouts in 26 and two-thirds innings. He has an outstanding curveball, and he will be throwing that especially when he's ahead on the count. But O'Brien's curve is so good that a lot of times it goes in the dirt. And it was O'Brien's wild pitch in the eighth inning after he had come in relief down in Lake Charles, which allowed the tying run to score in a ball game that Mcneese won in 9, and O'Brien took the loss in that game. So the big right-hander from Montreal, 6 feet, 5 inches tall, a 24-year-old sophomore, comes in now with runners at first and third to go up against Rand Prince. Gabriel, as Kyle mentioned, 6 2/3, 8 hits, 5 runs, 4 earned, and responsible for runners at the corners. A walk and 8 strikeouts. 119 pitches, which is about his limit. So O'Brien to face Prince here. If he's got the good yakker, he can be an awful lot of misery to try to hit against.
But you were about to say an awful lot of fun, and he's an awful lot of fun to watch from our vantage point if he's got that good one.
Those of you watching on television with a center field monitor will be able to see the break, and it's a very late, very sharp break on the curveball. Here is Prince. And O'Brien's first pitch. It's the curve, bouncing ball, great diving stop by Nelson Long, throwing at him. Oh my goodness. Nelson saves a run. And the Cajuns are out of the inning. No runs, 2 hits, no errors, 2 left. 7th inning stretch for the home folks. With your score, Cajuns 5, the Cowboys 5.
A long time ago, Piggly Wiggly became America's very first self-service supermarket, which helped shoppers save a lot of money. Today, people don't dress funny like they did back then, but Piggly Wiggly still helps shoppers with real low prices, the best and freshest foods, and lots of friendly smiles. I know, because my grandpa works there. Oh yeah, Piggly Wiggly. It's down home and down the street.
Visit your Piggly Wiggly's of Louisiana.
At Hops, we do whatever it takes to make your meal fresh and delicious.
Hey, I'm gonna show you boys how we fish. I'm the bear. Come to Papa, baby. You're not catching because you're not thinking. Fish on!
That's why Hops Fresh Seafood, Jamaican top sirloin, pastas, ribs, and microbrew beers taste so great.
Tough day, huh? Tell me about it.
Hops Restaurant, Bar, and Brewery, located on Ambassador Caffrey between the mall and the river.
Hops, it's all good.
Hops!
We're going to let him sing it. John Fogerty, the 7th inning stretch. I'll be quiet now. 5-5, Cajuns and Cowboys.
Well, I haven't gotten to the chorus yet, but it's become a tradition here at Teague Moore Field, and boy, the crowd is into this tonight. They all sing the chorus together.
Stalker in a 5-5 ball game, hits, or even at 8. This has been a dandy from Teague Moore Field.
Mazziotti has flied out, tripled, and walked. Squares to bunt, takes it low for ball one. Well, the two starting pitchers will not figure in the decision tonight. And what a play by Nathan Nelson on that pitch from O'Brien. Up and away, it's 2-0. Stark, about 4.5 walks per 9 innings. Two 2-0, outside corner, 2-1. The John Fogerty in the seventh inning stretch has been a tradition here for many years, and it's gotten to the point now when Cajun fans go on the road, they sing it even when the other guys are singing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. That pitch upstairs, 3-1. They'll just stand up, start the rhythmic clapping, and start singing. It doesn't matter what the home team is playing for their seventh inning stretch.
And that didn't go over in Mobile very well a couple of weeks ago.
3-1 pitch. Inside corner, and we're full 3-2.
But I'm quite sure that the Cajun fans really don't care what South Alabama people think about.
That's probably true. Here's the 3-2. Swung out, he just got a piece and fouled it off. Speaking of the Sun Belt today, Florida International and South Alabama have both lost. New Orleans is losing. And so the Cajuns could be their only hope to get a W in day one. Here's the 3-2 again. Inside, no, inside corner, strike three. Mazziotti called out on strikes. The first strikeout for Stark, the third for Mcneese State pitching tonight. One out for Will Hawkins. Hawkins has the collar tonight. He has struck out and grounded out twice. And if the Cajuns are going to make noise in a regional, it's almost imperative that Will Hawkins get hot. First pitch, foul back to the screen for strike one. Tommy Clark, the on-deck hitter. So Stark and O'Brien are the pitchers of record at this moment. Here's the 0-1. Down in the dirt, a ball and a strike. Nice job by Stark after falling behind Mazziotti to come back and get him. And they got him with a fastball that tailed over the inside corner. Here's the 1-1 to Hawkins. Swung out and fouled out of play, and the count is 1-2. Mcneese with 2 in the first and 3 in the third. They led 5-0. The Cajuns got a run in the fourth, 3 more in the fifth, and 1 on the Gill RBI triple in the sixth, which tied it. And that's where we stand now. 1-2 pitch. Down in the dirt, 2 balls and 2 strikes. Cajuns, if they win, will play at 3 tomorrow afternoon against East Carolina. If Mcneese wins, the Cajuns will play at 11 tomorrow morning against Marist. Here's the 2-2. Up high, 3 balls and 2 strikes. Winding Stark, the 3-2. Bouncing ball up the middle into center field for a base hit. Hawkins has his first hit of the night. And the Cajuns have a one-out single, and here comes Tommy Clark. Clark is singled, flied to left, and been hit by a pitch, 1-for-3. Hawkins will be lifted for the pinch runner here as Chase Bundy comes out of the dugout and will run for Hawkins. Check it, and it'll be Brett Bailey. Bailey will be the pinch runner and will stay in to play left field. So Hawkins, who statistically does not hit lefties well, hits one right back up the middle for a single, and here's Tommy Clark. Not a ton of difference in the speed between Hawkins and Bailey. Bailey does run better, but is not what you would call blazing fast. But Bailey is a better defensive left fielder. Pitch to Clark, popped him up. Foul territory, that's going toward the seats and out of play on the first base side. Again, the stretch by Stark and a throw to first base. Bailey is back. Bailey, not really a base stealing threat, although he has run on occasion this year. As we said, not tremendously faster than Hawkins. And again, the throw over to first base. Bailey on the season has stolen three bases and been caught three times. Cajun's more likely to use him in a hit and run situation than a straight steal. And again, the throw over.
It's amazing the perception of a pinch runner, isn't it? Despite the numbers, you know Mike Bianco has him in the Mcneese dugout.
Again, the stretch and the pitch. Delayed steal, throw down to second base. Safe, as they couldn't handle the throw. Bailey got a horrible jump. He moved off the bag, thought maybe the guy was coming to first, stopped, and then when he started again, Bailey took off. Salo's throw was low, and Landrino couldn't handle it. It's a stolen base for Bailey.
And you know, that's really a mistake by Brett Bailey, because my guess is you're probably going on first movement right there by the lefty. So it really doesn't matter if he goes to first behind you or not. You're supposed to take off.
One ball and one strike, the count to Clark, and now he steps out. The lead run is at second base with one out of the seventh. In a dandy ball game here this evening. Pitch outside for a ball, it's 2-1. The stretch and the 2-1 pitch. Bouncing ball towards short. Up with it is Kaiser. His throw is in time. On the play, Bailey moves to third, but now there are two outs. And Jess Poche, who has made the last out of an inning every time he's been up tonight, will try again. He struck out with a runner at first and two outs in the second. He flied out to end the fourth, and then with the bases loaded, flied to deep right field to end the fifth. Poche, 256 coming in. And the first pitch misses away for ball one. Poche, one of those guys that does hit lefties a little better than righties. But the numbers are very similar. Bouncing ball, foul. And the count is even, a ball and a strike. Bailey at third, the pinch runner with two outs. 5-5, our score, bottom of the seventh. Stark is ready. And the pitch. Up and away, and it's two balls and a strike. And again, Stark is ready. The pitch cut on and missed. And the count is even at 2-2. Nick Webb scheduled to go for the Cajuns tomorrow. If they play East Carolina, we'll probably see a right-hander for ECU. Here's the 2-2. Up high, three balls and two strikes. Will they throw him a fastball here? Poche, a fastball hitter with good power. He's got 9 home runs this year. He didn't, but the ball gets by, and the Cajuns are going to take the lead. Poche strikes out on a wild pitch. Bailey comes in to score, and it's 6-5. He threw him a breaker in the dirt. Poche went after it, but Salo couldn't hold it. Poche heads up, immediately took off for first base, and Bailey scored the run. And the Cajuns have scored 6 unanswered runs. Here is Atwood, throw to first base, runner back. Poche, 1-for-4 in stolen bases. He and Atwood probably run the least well on this whole ball club. Atwood has been on base 3 times, a single and 2 walks. He scored twice. Pitches high for a ball. Hawkins single. Bailey ran for him, stole second, went to third on a ground out, and scored on the strikeout wild pitch. Here's the 1-0. Fouled at the plate, 1-1. Atwood hitting 210. Average has gone up a little bit tonight. But remember, he's got very good power. And had 2 home runs in the Sun Belt Conference Tournament. Stretch and the pitch. Swing and a miss on the changeup, and it's 1-2. Atwood was out in front. If he gets on, Rick Heinel is next. And the Cajuns have now scored in 4 consecutive innings. Here's the 1-2. Swing and a miss, he struck him out. They'll have to throw him out at first base. And that'll take care of the Cajuns in the 7th inning. But the Cajuns take the lead with a run on 1 base hit. No errors and 1 runner left on base. We've played 7 with your score. Louisiana 6 and Mcneese State 5.
The Raging Cajuns of the University of Louisiana in the NCAA Regionals. Brought to you in part by Gulf Coast Bank. Delivering personal relationship banking is what they're all about. And by Beacon Alarms, 920 West Pinhook, Suite 219, your local authorized ADT dealer. And by Quality Brands, distributors of Miller's and Coors products. These sponsors are pleased to bring you the University of Louisiana Baseball, the Regionals.
Hello, Acadiana. It's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi. I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a 5-year warranty. Our brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a 5-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
Cajuns take the lead. In the bottom of the 7th inning, a single by Hawkins. Brett Bailey pinch ran for him, stole second base, went to third on Tommy Clark's ground out, and scored on the strikeout wild pitch with Jess Poche at the plate. Gordon O'Brien heads for his first full inning of work here. And it'll be Doug Cormier, Marty Guillory, and Josh Salo. 6, 7, and 8 in the Cowboy order.
Cormier is 0-for-2 with a sacrifice fly, drove in his 29th run of the year back in the 3rd inning, which was the last time Mcneese State scored. And O'Brien's first pitch is the curve, and it's in for a strike. Got to give Gabriel a lot of credit. Got roughed up early, gave up 5 runs over the first 3 innings, and then put goose eggs on the board after that. Gave the Cajuns a chance to come back. Here's the 0-1. Down low, it's a ball and a strike. Marty Guillory, Josh Salo will follow as you get a good look, if you're watching on television, at O'Brien. The Canadians pitch. There's the good yakker. And it's 1-2. O'Brien, when he doesn't have the good curveball, when it flattens out on him, is very hittable. Now time is called. Fans want the strikeout. Cajun pitchers have fanned 8 in the game and have walked only 1, and that was intentional. One-two pitch. Again, the curve, and he got a piece of it, and it stays 1-2. And I have news for Cormier and for anybody listening and anybody watching tonight. O'Brien's going to keep throwing that pitch. Trey Bullinger one of the Cajun closers, is throwing in the bullpen. Again, the 1-2. Again, the curve, and he struck him out. First strikeout for O'Brien, one out in the eighth inning, and here's Marty Guillory. 0-for-3 this evening. Guillory has flied to center, grounded to short, and flied to left. But we're going to have a pinch hitter here instead, as Mcneese will send up a lefty. It'll be Kirk Bradley to pinch hit for the Cowboys. Bradley on the year, 324. He normally starts against right-handed pitching. Six doubles, two triples, two homers, and 24 knocked in. And the first pitch is popped up in the air. Mazziotti coming back, has room, and makes the catch and then drops it. No, he didn't. He caught it. And that's out number two. So the pinch hitter, Bradley, is retired. Thought for a second, heard the crowd gasp. You probably saw it on your monitor, and shame on me for not looking at it. I was looking at the play and couldn't see whether he had caught it or not.
Well, it was his mask that went flying. He had the mask over and just at the last second got rid of it right in front of the screen. And then Nelson came over and kicked the mask out of the way. That's probably what you saw fly. It's excusable.
Now it'll be David Montiel, another pinch hitter, 80 at-bats this year, hitting at 287, a double, a homer, and 11 runs batted in. He is batting for Salo. Two outs, nobody on. Cajuns have now hit the Cowboys 9-8. And O'Brien's first pitch on the outside, but missed for ball one. Jason Kaiser, the shortstop, is scheduled next. And it is Kaiser in the on-deck circle. Here's the 1-0. Swung on, hit to center field. Feehan moves over. And it's a 1-2-3 inning for O'Brien in the eighth. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. We'll go to the bottom of the eighth with a score, Cajun 6, Mcneese State 5.
When did you first notice this problem?
It started a couple of months ago!
More or less!
Go on.
Personally, I don't see what the fuss is all about!
But we're losing friends!
Did you purchase a cellular phone?
We sure did!
Yelling over the static. Here, try Sprint PCS. They built the only all-digital, all-PCS nationwide network, so you'll be heard loud and clear.
Thank you.
No, thank you.
Sprint PCS, the clear alternative to cellular.
Do you need quick cash? The General Money Store makes instant cash loans up to $500 in 15 minutes. If you need a payroll advance, a personal loan, vacation money, or money for emergencies, or money just to play, go by the General Money Store today. The General Money Store is located inside the Super Kmart on Ambassador Caffrey. The efficient and experienced staff is there to show you the money. No credit checks and Social Security customers welcome. The General Money Store, your source for fast cash.
Cajuns have scored runs in each of the last four innings. And now have a 6-5 lead over the Mcneese State Cowboys as we head to the bottom half of the eighth inning with the Cajuns looking for just a little bit of insurance. And they'll have a chance with Rick Heidel, the 9-hole hitter, and then the top of the raging Cajun order in Stephen Feehan and Ryan Gill. Gordon O'Brien has come on for the last inning and a third, retired all four batters he's faced. And he has a chance to get the win for the raging Cajuns.
Heidel tonight has hit into a double play. Doubled home a run and scored in the fifth and then sacrificed in the sixth. He's 1-for-2. Obviously, Tony Robichaud would love to have an insurance run here. And they'll try to get that going against Stark. First pitch up high for ball one. Heidel, along with Nathan Nelson, have the biggest disparity batting against lefties and against righties. Heidel is hitting about 430 against left-handed pitching this year. There's a hard hit ground ball to short, but Kaiser will make that play and throw him out. Top of the order, Feehan has been on base once. He was hit by a pitch in the third inning. But he comes in at 0 for 3. Each team has made an error. Mcneese came in the outfield, and Gill was charged with a tough error back in the third inning. But all in all, a pretty well-played game tonight. Stark's first pitch, Feehan thought about a bunt, but that pitch bounced in front of home plate. And it's one ball and no strikes. You will see Feehan square many times if you watch him bat. What he likes to try to do is get the guy in from third base. Of course, that gets his odds up of hitting the ball through that side. Pitch is up high, and it's 2-0. New catcher in the game, Josh German, takes over for Salo. Pitch low, it's 3-0. Bradley stays in the game in right field after pinch hitting in the top half of the inning. The 3-0, and that's low ball four. For Stark, that is the first walk he's given up. Third walk tonight off Mcneese State pitching. And here is Ryan Gill. Gill is 3 for 4. Grounded to first in the first, singled in the third, singled home a run and scored in the fifth, and tripled home a run in the sixth. And the pitch, push bunt, but he couldn't get it past the pitcher, but nobody's covering. And Gill has got his fourth hit of the night. And that's a mistake by Williamson. Really, Kyle had no business getting that far off the bag.
No, the bunt that Ryan Gill put down wasn't an exceptional bunt. It was a high a bunt that took one big hop just a couple of feet to the right side of the pitcher's mound. And you know, Stark had that one going all the way. Williamson came in about five steps in front of the bag. You're right, he had no business being in that area.
Fourth time this year that Gill has had four hits in the game. Here's Nelson. First pitch, fouled out of play. Nelson is grounded to short, struck out, doubled and flied to right. He was the first batter that Stark faced when he came in the sixth inning with a runner at third and two outs. And on the very first pitch, Nelson flied to right field. 0-1 the count. There go the runners. Pitch is down in the dirt, rolls away. And for the second time tonight, Gill and Feehan have pulled off a double steal. For Feehan, his 13th stolen base of the year. Gill has his 20th. And now a Nelson hit here can give the Cajuns a three-run lead. Gill's doing it all tonight. Now he's playing the part of cheerleader. And now they will walk Nelson intentionally. And put it in the hands of Mazziotti. Well, with first base open and a guy hitting 370 up, you almost have to do this.
And then you have a chance to set up the double play. They'll obviously bring the infield in. Once they walk them, they'll play them all on the grass. You have a lot of opportunities to turn a double play in that situation. If not, you at least cut the runoff at home. Conversely, for a guy like Danny Mazziotti, who does hit a lot of line drives.
Oh, the pitch, but they didn't see it in time. Oh, wow.
You know, it's talked about a lot. I don't know if I've ever seen it, though. But you give it a couple of things you do defensively. Mazziotti hits a lot of line drives. You have a chance for a line out into a double play, but it also opens up a lot of space, and you hear it all the time. It adds about 30 to 50 points to somebody's batting average.
And it's going to be interesting to see if they take the middle infielders and bring them in as well, since a double play would get them out of the inning. Mike Bianco is out to the mound and probably to discuss how they're going to play it in the infield. When you look into the bullpen for Mcneese, Chet Medlock, who's scheduled to pitch tomorrow, has a save this year. So does Jory Poirier, but the Cajuns have seen him a couple of times and hit him hard. Mcneese, as a staff, only has five saves this year, and Stark leads the team with two. Mazziotti has flied to center, tripled, walked, and been called out on strikes. Cajuns now with 10 hits. Mazziotti, of course, leads this team in home runs with 13. A simple fly ball to the outfield will get a run home. First pitch, foul out of play.
And Mcneese will play the middle infield back with the corners in. And that's usually the by-the-book strategy. But, you know, in a situation like this, everything has to go right to turn a double play. You can't have one bobble. You can't have one loss of footing. Everything has to go right to turn a double play in the middle.
Here's the 0-1. Outside, a ball on the strike.
Which is why, at times, coaches will bring everybody in and you play for the cutoff run at the plate, because everything has to go right to turn a double play in the middle infield.
Remember, Hawkins was lifted, and so Brett Bailey is the on-deck hitter. 1-1 pitch. Up high, 2-1. He went 3-0 to Mazziotti the last time that Danny was up, but came back to strike him out. Here it's two balls and one strike. A base hit will break this one open a little bit and give the Cajuns some breathing room. Stretch, 2-1 pitch. Up high, 3-1. Crowd on its feet. 3-1 pitch. Up high, ball four. The Cajuns get another run, and it's 7-5. For Mazziotti, his 37th run batted in of the year. Nelson moves to second, Gill to third. Feehan scores to make it 7-5. Now, Kyle, Brett Bailey is up, and we have seen it on three different occasions this year. He handles the bat extremely well. He is a very good push bunter. And if he can get one out there toward the second baseman, the Cajuns will get another run. In the meantime, Mcneese is going to do it with another pitcher. Mike Bianco back out to the mound, and he'll make the change. While he makes it, we'll break it. 7-5, Cajuns lead it. We'll be back here at Teague Moore Field right after this timeout.
The Crystal Cottage in Lafayette is your party headquarters for Acadiana. The Crystal Cottage specializes in wedding and party tents. Select tents that are simple or elaborate for every occasion. Crystal Cottage has frame tents that are elegant, sturdy, and impervious to the elements. Crystal Cottage also rents tables and chairs, glassware, linen, stages, lighting, and dance floors to complement your occasion. If you need tents for weddings, outdoor receptions, or parties, see the tent consultants at the Crystal Cottage. The Crystal Cottage in the Grand Marché Shopping Center, 4525 Johnston, Lafayette.
Richard's Seafood Patio in Abbeville is now serving boiled crabs. Richard's is now open, serving boiled crabs along with fried and grilled seafood. Boiled, fried, and grilled seafood at its Cajun best. Richard's is open 7 days a week at 5 p.m. Richard's Seafood Patio in Abbeville.
Three down. 36 and a third innings for Porsche. 35 hits, 18 runs, 16 of those earned. 30 strikeouts and 13 walks. Opponents hit 252 against him. Pat Stark goes an inning and two-thirds, gives up a couple of hits. Two runs both earned, responsible for all three Cajuns on the sacks. Three walks, one intentional, a couple of strikeouts and a wild pitch. 45 pitches for Pat Stark in those inning and two-thirds.
Porsche had an appearance against the Cajuns in Lafayette. He pitched one inning, gave up two hits, two runs, with a walk and a strikeout. In fact, the two runs he gave up were a two-run homer to Will Hawkins. So Porcier comes in here with the bases loaded and one out, one run already home. The Cajuns have now scored in five consecutive innings and lead this one 7-5. As we were saying about Bailey, in late inning situations on three different occasions this year, he was brought to the plate and got the push button down. In fact, all three times it went for a base hit. If he can get it past the pitcher here, all they want to do is be able to get the bunt down to get the run home. They don't necessarily want Bailey to have to bunt for a base hit. There you see what the junior has done this year. And the first pitch hit to left field, hit well. Going back to left fielder, reaches up, makes the catch. Tagging is Gill. He will score, and Bailey gets the run home, and the Cajuns have a three-run cushion. They let Bailey swing away, and he hit it hard. Parker was able to go back and get it. Nelson at second and Mazziotti still at first. And for Bailey, his 14th run batted in of the year. And it's a three-run lead for Louisiana as Tommy Clark comes up. Singled, flying to left, hit by a pitch, grounded to short, 1-for-3. 4-Shea ready. Runners go. Pitch, throw, wild. Here comes Nelson. Mazziotti's on his way to third, and it's 9-5, and the Cajuns have a three-run inning. Stolen base for Nelson, and an error to the catcher, German, allowing the runners to move up. For Nelson, his 29th stolen base of the year. For Mazziotti, his 7th. And the Cajuns, as they've done so many times this year, when they get up on you, they're going to run on you. And they forced Mcneese to make a mistake. Change up, and Clark was way out in front, strike one.
Minnesota leads Wichita State 10-6, bottom of the seventh inning. Stanford on top of Fresno, 1-0, top of the fourth. Princeton still leads Houston 6-5, that one bottom of the eighth. And Southwest Texas continue to lead Baylor. In fact, they're shutting them out, 4-0, top of nine.
1-1 pitch, way high, it's 2-1.
Oklahoma on top of Oral Roberts, 2-1, bottom of the fifth in a rain delay. Arizona State on top of Miami, Ohio, 7-0, that one top of the second inning. And North Carolina leads Penn State, 10-4, top of the eighth. Loyola Marymount, 4-0 over Cal State Fullerton, bottom of the second.
2-1 pitch, fouled out of play, and the count goes to 2-2. Heidel grounded out to lead off the inning. Feehan walked, Gill had a bunt single. They moved up on a double steal. Nelson was walked intentionally, Mazziotti unintentionally. Bailey a sacrifice fly, and then a double steal and an error. 2-2 pitch. It goes deep to left field, and that ball is gone. A home run for Tommy Clark. And the Cajuns lead it 11-5. For Clark, his 7th home run of the year. RBIs 39 and 40, and the Cajun comeback is complete. They have scored now 11 unanswered runs. And a 5 spot here in the 8th. Here is Poche. Struck out, fly to center, fly to right. And then struck out again, but on his second strikeout, a wild pitch was thrown and allowing him to reach and allowing Bailey to score the go-ahead run and what now would be the winning run in this game. And the pitch is inside for ball one. First home run of the tournament. That's down in the dirt, it's 2-0.
Well, since Mazziotti scored in the fourth, the Cajuns have scored 11 runs. Mcneese has made 14 outs. That'll get it done late in the game. By the way, that game over in Baton Rouge is a final. UL Monroe has beaten New Orleans 8-3.
2-0 pitch, foul back to the screen, it's 2-1. So the only hope for the Sun Belt to get a win in day one is right here. South Alabama losing to Mississippi State 7-2. Florida International 14-6, they lose to Florida Atlantic. And that pitch fouled out of play. The count is 2-2. So Kenny Holabek getting it done, and Louisiana Monroe will now face LSU tomorrow New Orleans will take on Jackson State in the loser's bracket. There's a shot to center field. That'll fall for a base hit. Hoche is on, and for the second time in this game, the Cajuns are going to bat around. As Atwood comes up, walked, singled, walked, and struck out. He has scored twice. Twelve hits now for the Cajuns. Give the Cajun hitters a lot of credit, but again, give a lot of credit to Gabriel as well, who after the third inning shut Mcneese down. Gave his team a chance to come back. Breaking ball is in for strike one. Heidel, who grounded out earlier this inning, and it seems like a long time ago, waiting on deck. That pitch in for a strike, and the count is nothing and two.
Going back to that Baton Rouge region tomorrow, LSU and UL Monroe, you figure the Indians will go with Mike Wambacher, who was the Southland Conference Player of the Year and had an ERA of about 2.5 this season.
There's the swing and a miss. He struck him out and the inning is over. But nine come to the plate for the Cajuns in the eighth. Five of them score on three base hits. There was one Mcneese State error and one man left on base. At the end of eight, Louisiana 11 and Mcneese State 5.
Springtime, and that means the 2000 Men's College World Series returns to Omaha, Nebraska. Don't miss the best teams in college baseball slug it out at Johnny Rosenblatt Stadium, June 9th through the 17th. For tickets, call 402-422-1212. That's 402-422-1212. Or log on to NCAAChampionships.com.
Hello, Acadiana. It's Mark Hampton at Hampton Mitsubishi. I've got a brand new Glant 2000 for $259 a month with air conditioning, with automatic, and a 5-year warranty. Or a brand new Mirage for $189 a month with air conditioning, with a 5-year warranty, and gets 40 miles to a gallon. How do we get payments that low with 1.9% financing for 60 payments? Only Hampton has it.
Tallahassee final, Florida State 6.
Well, the Cajuns went to the bottom of the eighth looking for an insurance run. They got it five times over. And we go to the top of the ninth inning with the Cajuns suddenly in control of this one by a score of 11-5 for Mcneese. Here in the ninth inning, it'll be Kaiser, Parker, and Landrino. 9-1-2 in the order to face Gordon O'Brien.
For the Cowboys, shortstop number 11, Jason Kaiser.
Kaiser leads off. He's one out of three. O'Brien stands to get his second win of the year if he can hold the 6-run lead. And the first pitch is a curve in for strike one. Parker and Landrino to follow as Mcneese gets to the top of the order. And in a 1-run game, it would be real nervous time with the top of the order coming up. Not so much with the 6-run cushion. Swing and a miss. There's strike two. O'Brien has faced four batters. He's retired all four. On a ground out where Nelson made a great play, a strikeout, a foul ball, and a fly ball. 0-2 pitch. There's strike three called. Good morning, good afternoon, and good night. And Kaiser is gone.
160. The NCAA thanks you for your support.
10th strikeout for Cajun pitching, second for O'Brien in the game. There's one out of the ninth inning for Nolan Parker. Parker has grounded to short, singled and scored, flied to center, and then hit that ball that went off Poche's glove that ricocheted to Gill, where he threw to Gabriel covering in one of the greatest defensive plays that we've seen tonight. Pitch up high for a ball. It's 1-0. We've seen Gill make a couple. And, of course, Nelson with the diving play at third with two out in the seventh, which preserved a 1-run Cajun lead. And let me take that back. It kept it a tie ball game kept Mcneese State from taking the lead. And that pitch down to the dirt, it's 2-0. That might not have been the flashier of the plays, but it was the most important.
Well, it had the most substance for sure. Diving stop right on the line, saved a run, and that came off the bat of Rand Prince, who is an outstanding runner. Runs really, really well. And to be able to go across your body, make a diving play at the line, get to your feet, and throw across in time to get a fast runner is pretty special.
Here's the 2-0. In for a called strike, and it's 2-1. If this thing holds, the Cajuns will play tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock against East Carolina. There's a ground ball towards short. Two hopper to Heidel. Two outs. Since the third inning, when Mcneese State got their three runs, they have had only two base hits.
And four base runners.
And four base runners since one out in the third inning. Stuart Landreneau's been on base four times. He's got three hits and a walk, a single, a double, a triple. He's a home run away from the cycle. O'Brien's curve is in for strike one. The Cajun bullpen is quiet. Trey Bullinger was up last inning, but now this one is for O'Brien to finish. 0-1 pitch swung on, ground ball foul. It's 0-2. And the Cajuns are one strike away from advancing. O'Brien sets. 0-2 pitch. Swung on and fouled out of play. Cajuns win, if they get it here, will be their 43rd of the year. That will tie the most for a Tony Robichaud-coached club at 43 wins. 3 years ago. Again, the 0-2. Fouled out of play again. So Landreneau won't go quietly. Kevin Mitchell is the on-deck hitter, but Mcneese is down to its last out, trailing by six. And for those of you who turned off the television when it was 5-0 and just turned it back on, surprise, surprise, surprise. Again, the 0-2, up high, a ball and two strikes. We mentioned earlier, O'Brien is 24 years old, just a sophomore. When you go to college up in Canada, it does not count against your eligibility. And O'Brien had never played anything but summer ball because there is no college baseball in Canada. Again, the pitch. Tried to check his swing, couldn't do it, ball game over. O'Brien comes in, retires all seven men that he faces, and picks up his second win of the year. But the story in this game, the Cajun bats have come alive tonight. As Louisiana comes back from a 5-0 deficit, they score 11 unanswered runs and defeat Mcneese State tonight by the score of 11-5. The Cajuns will now play in the 3 o'clock game tomorrow afternoon against East Carolina. That game will be on radio and television. Mcneese State falls and into the loser's bracket. They'll play Marist tomorrow morning at 11. My guess is those of you on the television side will be leaving us now. And since it's close to 10 o'clock, for Kyle Siebold, I'm Jay Walker. Thanks so much for joining us. Those of you on the radio side, a conversation with Louisiana baseball coach Tony Robichaud. When we come back in 2 minutes on the Raging Cajun Radio Network.
El Hilton, Kinder, and Oberlin can now catch KLAF on Communicom's cable channel 3. UPN programs like WWF SmackDown, Star Trek Voyager, Malcolm and Eddie, and Moesha have made KLAF one of the hottest UPN affiliates in the country. Include live sports coverage of LSU baseball, ice skaters hockey, SEC basketball, local high school football, and you'll see why KLAF's so hot.
I have a secret.